resource vote is not here for the meeting, we'll have to take it off.
As a reserve for this time frame, we're waiting for the fourth.
Commissioner Levant, with respect to the next item that I need added, it would be a item pertaining to the Oaks Senior Living LLC. It is an agreement to proceed at risk in their assisted living facility based upon the inavailability of sewer, and I will discuss that why sewer may be in dispute when we get there, but I do need this on a time-sensitive basis to be added as an agreement to proceed at risk.
Number 27, Councilman.
This would be the next item, number 27.
So moved.
Second.
Adding number, item number 27, time sensitive, for Oak Senior Living LLC, agreement for sewer, agreement to be proceeding at risk.
Yes, sir.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. That passes 3-0, waiting for the fourth.
That's all, Commissioner Levant, thank you.
Just a little FYI, I'm not sure. I haven't spoken to Commissioner Bell. I don't know if we're going to move over 25 or not. I don't know. 25. Okay.
Well, number 20.
25. We may postpone it when he gets here.
I got you.
Okay.
Number one, board consideration. Oh, I'm sorry. Motion to adopt the agenda. That's that.
Second.
We have a motion to second to adopt the agenda as is. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All against, or none, passes 3-0. Number one, board consideration, proposed MOU for Forsyth County and the Lake Lanier Association. Commissioner Ball.
Yes. Members of the board, Commissioner Boff and I did add this. We have a history of supporting the Lake Lanier Association and supporting financially. This year is a little different in that they have a new area they're trying to educate people on safety on the lake. We've had a number, as you know, a number of incidents on the lake, and the Lake Lanier Association would like to step up and ask for support to help educate the public on not only the environmental aspects of the lake, but also now the safety of the lake. So I believe there are some people here who might be able to answer some questions should we have them, but Councilor, I'm not seeing you here, but I thought that they were asking for $20,000, is that correct?
Somewhere between 15
yes.
and 20 is what average is.
Is what we normally give them 10?
Yeah.
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 I think I noticed Val Perry, who I think is a representative of the Lake Lanier Association. I understand.
And that's what?
Val Perry.
Is Val Perry? Yeah. Would you have anything you'd like to add to this, sir?
Well, please do.
Sure. I'm on the board of the association, and we certainly thank you for your support in the past. You've done a lot of it. Most all of the commissioners have voted in favor of it. And this year, one of the things that we have done, I think we've been giving you periodic updates on that, is the support for taking the lake up 2 feet, which gets a extra new reservoir for the state. And really, it becomes an insurance policy for just about everybody. As you know, the lake is down about 10 feet now, and it would only be down about 6 had it been taken up 2 more feet. So we think that that will work, and there have been a lot of positive things that have happened with the tri-states. I'm sure you've all read about that, and the governor is really in favor of that as well. So we've been one of the driving forces on that 1073 strategy, which is taking it up 2 feet. What we've done new is something that I'm sure you all are just as aware of as I am. But in the summer, there was several accidents on the lake, and several of those were boating accidents. and at least three were ones that caused the deaths of people on the lake. And there was extreme publicity, negative publicity, about Lake Lanier as a result of particularly the one boat that crashed into the pontoon boat, and two young men perished in that. And it took 6 or 7 days to find the body of the second boy. And of course, that gave very bad publicity for the lake. And we think also bad publicity for really the county and the other surrounding counties here, because the lake is one of the big engines that drives some of the economy that we all enjoy in Forsyth County. So we have put together, along with the Corps of Engineers and the Department of Natural Resources, the marinas, the marine trade people, the power squadron, a number of retailers, as well as sailing clubs and so forth, a Lake Lanier Water Safety Alliance. And what we've tried to do in that alliance, and it's really fledgling, we just started that in the last month, is we want to focus on what can be done now for the lake, as opposed to the things that the legislature is going to have to take over and manage. We don't want to get involved with whether the BUI is the same as DUI, the amount of alcohol. We don't want to get into licensing. We don't want to get into speed limits, because we don't believe that we can support that, and it's going to have to go through the legislature anyway. And so we're part and parcel to a legislative caucus on this subject, but we're really just an assist person. What we're focusing on is education commitment, and really a focus on safety. And one of the biggest problems, and many of you that partake on the lake know that safety is something that very few people focus on unless there's somebody talking to you about it. I had one fellow tell me that in order to drive a jet ski, all you need is a credit card. You don't have to know about water. You don't have to know that they don't stop. They don't back up. You can't steer them unless you're on the gas pedal or on the accelerator. Just have a credit card and you can get one. You can buy it or you can rent it. What we want to do is to get awareness and education to be on the forefront of any of the 8 million people who use this lake at least once a year. I'm one of those. I live on the lake. And I'm only counted as one of the 8 million. So it's a very popular lake. It's a great economic engine for all of North Georgia and certainly Forsyth County. Forsyth County is where I live. A number of our board members live here. Forsyth County is of our membership, which is about 3,000 people. Forsyth County has over 45% of that. And the other counties are nowhere near as supportive as Forsyth County. In fact, we're trying to make you all the model as we go to see other counties that surround the lake. So that really is what we're doing. We've added to the 1073 strategy and our focus there, a real focus and drive for safety, awareness, and safety education on the lake. There are 12 classes you can take to get a Georgia certified certificate for having passed a safety class. And we had almost all of the agencies that ran them, like the Power Squadron, like the DNR and so forth. But they do 100 a year, 15 a year. And what we want to do is really focus on that. And the insurance companies that give insurance for boats, for instance, will give a discount if you pass the safety class. But nobody knows that. And the insurance companies are going to run around bragging on, we'll give you 5 or 10%. We're going to brag on it, and we're going to try to get some of the local merchants involved in that. And there are a myriad of things that we're trying to work on. One is to have a sticker that goes on every single boat that has Robert's rules of how to drive and what are the things to watch out for. And that all those kinds of things take money. So that's why we had asked Brian and Jim and some others to see if we could up the contribution to our association from $10,000 to $20,000 for this year. So that's kind of my story. I would put another aside there. You know, we have a major cleanup in Lake Lanier Association sponsored. It's this Saturday coming up. And one of our strongest supporters is Keep Forsyth Beautiful. They manage one of the captain's locations at Baldridge Marina, and the people from there are very, very supportive and have gotten us some good support in terms of dumpsters and all the things that go into that. So just a little plug for Forsyth County. That's the story. And if I can answer any questions, I'll certainly try.
Mr. Perry, did you say we're the first county you're asking for extra money for this?
Well, let me put it this way. We have asked all of them for money. You are the first ones we've come to this year. We tried with Gwinnett, and if you'll recall, 5 or 6 years ago, we sued the EPD to make sure they wouldn't put dirty treated sewage in the lake. And Gwinnett joined EPD against us. Well, we won that. However, there are some long memories in Gwinnett County, so we're working through Gwinnett. I think we're going to get there. We have a good rapport in Dawson County, and we're beginning to get good rapport in Hall County. So those four are really the ones. Gwinnett is helping us on some other things, and we expect to get a contribution this year from them, from Dawson, and from Hall County.
I really appreciate all that you do. There's a lot of effort there, especially the cleanup and such.
It's a big deal for us this weekend.
It is a precious resource that we can care for, that's going to care for us.
I'll make a motion that we, I guess this is an MOU, Counselor?
It is, Mr. Chairman, and before you make your motion, just listening to the representative speak, we'll probably need to put together a variation on this MOU. I mean, one of the things we've got to do is I've got to bring you back an MOU that has some deliverables in it.
All right.
And the deliverables that I heard were education, cleanup, boater safety, and lobbying for the 1071 to 1073, I think is what I heard. Did I get that? So we'll put that together for you. So whatever you make a motion for with respect to the amount, I'll need to put it together such that there's some deliverables that are recognizable, some reporting requirements, which they're used to. They've already got those now. And bring that back to you at another meeting or a consent agenda.
So it'll be another meeting before we perform the approval.
All right.
Okay. I'd make that motion that we direct staff to come back to the MOU and changing the contribution from $10,000 to $20,000 with the deliverables that you just mentioned.
Second for discussion. What up, Dave? Would we normally budget for $10,000?
No, this is not funding the budget.
This is not funding the budget.
Last year when it was approved, we found the funds and aligned within the board's accounts for professional support services. But no, it's not in the originally adopted budget.
Okay, so can we find $20,000?
I think we can at this point in the year.
Without hurting the budget?
I think so.
It's a good effort. Good job.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Appreciate your support. You know, I've lived here in the county for almost 30 years, and it's a great county.
Thank you for all your efforts.
Thank you.
On item number one, we have a motion. We have a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All against? All aye. Passes 3-0. Item number four, review of ratification for previously approved contract between Smartben and Forsyth County for employee benefit electronic enrollment services, Director of Personnel Services.
Yes, Commissioners. The contract between Smartben and Forsyth has previously been approved in the work session of August the 7th, contingent upon review, legal review by counsel. That review has been completed. It did result in a great deal of changes, really to help better protect the county. But the deliverables are still the same. The one of the changes, though, does increase the cost by $2,500. And This was the recommendation to carry additional liability insurance, that Smartben carry additional liability insurance. As they only had around 12,000, I believe, right? Yeah. And council recommended to 2 million. So Smartben was willing to accommodate, but the additional cost needed to be passed on, so that would be around $2,500. We ask that you do approve the agreement as time sensitive, with authorization of the county manager to execute the agreement.
So how much is it increase our liability to up to?
2 million.
2 million.
What's the total cost?
25. It's just up to 25. So that's what we're doing today, just putting the extra 2,500.
And approve plus the agreement.
And re-approve
the agreement.
Yes.
Mr. I'd like to make a motion that we approve the agreement between Smartben and Forsyth County Government for employee benefit and electronic enrollment services, and the county manager to execute any agreement and approve the $2,500 extra.
Yes,
and
it's
time-sensitive. Second. Item number four, we have a motion and a second. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All against? There are none. Passes 3-0.
For time sensitive.
Item number five.
Thank you. This request is to confirm the reappointments to the Board of Ethics of three of its members, Mr. Lorne Twyer, as the Civil Service Board's appointment that would commence August the 3rd. 2012, Mr. Tim Perry, the elected official's appointment commencing July 2nd, 2012, and Mr. Rusty Ricketson, the employee's appointment commencing 7-2-2012. I understand that the ethics ordinance is in the process of being reviewed and changed, but felt that it'd be important to have this for the board. So that the appointment could at least be applied for the interim until such time the ethics ordinance is approved.
Just to add to what Ms. Carson just said, you know, certainly we had sent correspondence to the existing ethics board basically asking that they stay on irrespective of their terms ending, just as hold over, given what the Board of Commissioners was doing with respect to the ethics ordinance. I just felt that it was important for Pat to continue processing things in the ordinary course, bringing this to you. But I would be very comfortable if you all, having heard this, still wanted to postpone till the October work session, simply because this all may become moot the first public hearing in October if you, in fact, decide to approve the new ethics board configuration.
To the third, postpone to
October 9th.
So moved. Postpone item 5 to October
9th.
Second. Postponing item number 5, October 9th, we have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Against? Bar none. It passes 3-0.
Thanks.
On item number 6. Mr. Chairman, Director.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Member of the Board. This first item is for a renewal of the maintenance agreement for the Watson Road and Gilbert Road water tanks. This is a five-year agreement that is spread over the years, and the cost is spread over those that time for annual review of it, maintenance of it, painting as needed, and any repairs. We are asking to renew this from October to December 31st of 2013, so we get this contract on an annual basis moving forward. At this time, we ask for renewal of the agreement with utility service in the amount of $125,229.45. Thank you.
Motion from the board.
I'll make a motion to approve the agreement with the utility service in the amount of $125,229.45.
This has nothing to do with the, we have say which service transmitters on any of those things?
That's nothing to do with this.
This has nothing to do with it.
This is just for the maintenance of the actual water tank.
Item number six, we have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All against, bar none, passes 3-0. Item number seven, Superintendent Director.
Thank you, Commissioners. This item is for continuation of our natural gas service provider, which is currently with Coweta-Fayette EMC, and we do have a renewal clause in this agreement. I am asking this to be time sensitive, as our contract will be expiring. It is currently, we pay $6.50 for the pipeline, the DDDC, which is a reduced rate because of the gas amount that we use. And right this morning, our cost this morning was at 0.437 per therm. And as you know, that varies by the moment in the day. So I'd ask that you give me a spread that we could lock it in at. So at this time, I'd ask if you could lock it in between 0.437 and 0.42. And hopefully we can get it lower than that.
So 0.42 and 437.
Right. I said it backwards. Yeah. Thank you.
Renew the contract for natural gas with Coweta-Fayette Natural Gas with a range of 0.42 to 0.437. Is that per therm?
Per therm.
It is time sensitive.
Second, time
sensitive. Item number seven, we have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All against, there are none, passes 3-0.
Thank you.
Thank you. Item number eight, request approval of memorandum of agreement with Metropolitan North Georgia Water Planning District to continue to participate in the district-wide toilet. Retrofit program. Director of Water and Sewer.
Yes, good afternoon, Board. This is requesting approval of this MOU with the district. This will dedicate $25,000 for the toilet retrofit program. What this does is replaces older toilets pre-1993 with high efficiency 1.28 gallon per flush toilets. It's part of the water conservation program. It satisfies the district and EPD requirement to replace older inefficient plumbing fixtures. This is a continuation of the program we've been at since 2009. We've issued 262 rebates to date, and we've expended the original $25,000 that was dedicated to this program. So we're asking that it be reallocated with $25,000, and it'll continue until that is expended. So we're asking for approval of this MOU.
The retrofit rebate, does it go to the homeowner?
It goes to the homeowner. They can get $100. Per toilet, well, with a maximum of two toilets per household.
Is that per water bill? They could actually get a rebate.
We credit them on their water bill.
Okay.
Any other questions? Motion from the board.
Motion to approve the memorandum of agreement with the Metropolitan North Georgia Water Planning District to continue to participate in the district-wide toilet retrofit program.
Time sensitive. Second, time sensitive.
All right, so we have a motion and we have a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All against, there are none, passes 3-0. Item number nine.
Mr. Commissioners, we're requesting approval to design and construct a restroom building at Eugen Hill Trailhead. This restroom building will have to be built up out of floodplain. So we're estimating the cost at $150, but it could be higher since we have to build up floodplain.
Any questions?
Jared, this money coming out of, what's this money coming from?
We're looking to get the money out of SPLOST 6.
SPLOST 6. Do we have it there or are we just waiting for it?
Well, we have some that we've saved on other projects.
Mm-hmm.
Is there one there now?
There's not one there.
There's not one there now.
It's Porter. It's required.
Porter John's.
There's not one at Farnham either. There's Porter John down there, so on your way, right. Walking, this will be something that will be well.
Well, trails in flood plain. We got bathrooms in flood plain.
I make a motion that we approve, move forward with restroom building at Union Hill Trailhead. Money to come out of SPLOST 6.
Second.
Is that time sensitive?
No. No, sir. Wait on question. Item number 9, we have a motion and a second to approve the restroom.
Question. We're gonna
have
a park. We're gonna put a park
on
there.
Sorry.
Or is that okay?
Yeah, and then use
limits
of roads and stuff.
Millions.
Put a motion a second for number 9. All in favor, signify by saying aye. Okay. All against? There are none. Passes 3-0. Skipping number 10. Open the video, Mr. Bell. Morning, number 11. Approval of change order for Moreland Upbelly for additional design services for Bethelview Road, widening the Castleberry Road to SR 20, as required by GDOT to meet current policies and procedures. Director of Engineer.
Yes, this item is hopefully the last change order we'll have to complete the design on Bethelview Road. The amount is $246,972. Moreland Altabelli has outlined the reasons for the need for this additional design work. It's about 18 new developments. They've got to do some re-evals, then write environmental documents. There'll be some wall designs that are now required to minimize the impacts on certain developments. And during right-of-way negotiations, we anticipate there'll be some redesign that will be needed. So they've taken that into consideration. And in addition to some permitting requirements through the stream buffer variance and 404 permit will be required for the project. So I would ask that the board approve this change order. It actually brings the total design up to about $2 million now. This includes phase 1 and 2. Originally, when the design was started in 1999, it was contracted for $800,000, but since then, there have been multiple change orders due to design issues and changes in requirements from GDOT. We had to split the project into two phases and a lot of new development, but this should finish up the design for the project, and therefore, I'd recommend that the board authorize this change order to Moreland Altabelli to complete the design.
Questions? I'll have one. Certainly, we rely on you to judgment on these things. And this is just phase 1 from Castleberry to 400. When do they expect that to go forward?
It's under contract for construction. They should be moving in on a project anytime. I haven't been down there lately, but I was anticipated that CW Matthews should move in this fall. The completion date for phase 1 is, I believe it's May of 2014, May or June of 2014. So it's under contract, so it should be under construction shortly. And this phase 2 will pick up just north of Castleberry and carry to State Route 20. At the last work session, the board approved the right-of-way agreement with GDOT. That's been forwarded downtown. As soon as we get a notice to proceed from GDOT, we'll start right-of-way acquisition probably within the next month. And we've got about 2 years to complete and certify that right-of-way. And then GDOT will be funding 100% of the construction for the project.
Have you bought any right-of-way on phase 2 yet? Or just
none on phase 2 yet. We hadn't got authorization yet from GDOT. As soon as we get the right-of-way agreement executed and they give us notice to proceed, then we'll have Moreland Altabelli start appraising right-of-way and start making offers. So we should be making offers by the end of the year and likely won't close anything before the first of the year.
This is my district. I'll make a motion that we approve the change order for Moreland Altabelli for additional design services for Bethelview Road, widening Castleberry Road, SR 20, as required by GDOT to meet current policies and procedures. not to exceed $246,972. And is this time sensitive?
It is not.
I second, since we shared this room.
Yeah, I guess we did.
We did.
Sorry. Does that mean we have to go on to really well, don't we?
Sure. Yeah.
You have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye. All against? All in, it passes 3-0. Item number 12.
Number 12 is an approval of task order from Moreland Alphabella to perform additional right-of-way services for Bethelview Road Phase 2, Castleberry State Route 20, in a not-to-exceed amount of $581,000. Just to continue on from the previous item, under Moreland's current program management agreement with the county, they can provide appraisal services for the county. We'll be handling the right-of-way negotiations in-house. There's over 200 parcels that we'll be acquiring, and this is the estimated amount to get the appraisal work done for the project, and we'd recommend the board move forward with and approve this task order more than out the belly for $581,000.
Well, Mr. Commissioner, since we both share this point, Tori, I'd like to make a motion to approve the task order for more than out the belly to perform additional right-of-way services for Bethelview Road Phase 2, Castleberry Road State Route 20, in amount not to exceed $581,000. Not time sensitive.
I'll second it since the motion. We have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All against? There are none. Passes 3-0. Item number 13, we're going to skip for now. Commissioner 14 was postponed, 15 was postponed, 16 was postponed, 17 and 18 we're going to hold for the request of Mr. Bell, 18 has been postponed, 19 to hold for Mr. Bell, we are on to number 20. Board consideration of placing limited restrictions to online access to certain personnel information of judges, prosecutors, and law enforcement, county attorney.
Board members, thank you for this. This request actually originated out of the tax commissioner and tax assessor's office, and they called with a very legitimate concern. Their concern was, based upon the new rewrite to the Open Records Act, explain it this way. The old Open Records Act used to contain some express exemptions for certain personal information relating to public safety officers, prosecutors, and judges being releasable at all, particularly in the realm of home phone number, home address, and immediate dependents. And of course, the public policy rationale behind that was, is if that information was freely available or freely accessible, there could be individuals that intend to secure that information and possibly do them harm, et cetera. When the bill was rewritten, that language was sort of included into a catch-all that said that records pertaining to public employees will be subject to those sorts of redactions, home address, home telephone number, dependents, for all public employees, if the actual document that contains that information identifies on the face of the document that the individual about whom it relates to is a public official. In other words, the document itself has to say, Mr. Bagley as a city superior court judge or as a public employee. Well, a lot of the records that contain that information don't have that on them. And a lot of that information in Forsyth County is contained online, not the least of which might be, for instance, property tax information. Well, the assessor and the commissioner were about to go ahead and take off all the bars, the redactions they had on that information. And of course, some of the folks that will be implicated by that raised the hand and said, really? I work on the narcotics unit and you're gonna release information about where I live, et cetera. Well, there's no real easy answer to this except I can say this rather affirmatively. We can't violate the Open Records Act, so I won't come to you and ever ask that. We have to make this information available if it's requested. But with respect to making it available online, anonymously, you know, such that it can be reviewed anonymously at any time of the day, and us having no knowledge of who all has accessed the information, we can do something about that. So the purpose of this resolution would simply be that it would allow for online access with respect to law enforcement, police, and prosecutors, that information to continue to be withheld by way of redaction or what have you. But it would also provide that on that, wherever it's withheld online, it has to say it's being withheld and is subject to an Open Records Act. If anybody else wants it, they can still get it. They'll just need to tender an Open Records Act request to the county and they'll have access to it. But it's sort of an accommodation attempting to first of all, understand that these folks may have a legitimate, reasonable interest in not having their property address and their home telephone number and their dependents, if any, if that is online, released. On the other hand, we have to observe the Open Records Act, and we have to. So that's the purpose behind this resolution.
Councilman, is it up to the county or up to the individual, say we hire a new law enforcement person that's associated with narcotics? Is it up to him to come to us to tell them to redact? I mean, are we responsible to do that on our own?
I think that right now we've got a pretty good relationship where there's a flow of information that provides our folks in IT and the tax commissioner's office, that sort of information. To be quite candid to you, I'm not exactly sure how it gets communicated, but I know that historically we've done a pretty good job of having that line of communication open. We obviously did a good job because we told everybody when we were about to release it as well, and that's what got sort of the hue and cry that resulted in us trying to come to you with some sort of a resolution.
That's one of the consequences of this new Open Record Act that we didn't foresee?
Well, there's you know, whenever you take a law that big and sort of change it that much, there's always going to be some unintended consequences, and I don't know if this is an unintended consequence, but irrespective of whether it is or it isn't, we have to comply with it, but we can also take reasonable measures to safeguard our people to the extent we think that we should. And so we have to comply with the law, that's clear, but we also, you know, to the extent someone wants the information, they'll still have it, they can still get it, but at least there'll be a record of them asking for it.
I want to hear safeguard our people, so that's what we're doing.
That's what we're doing.
To the best of our ability.
Yes, sir.
Any more questions? Motion from the board?
I'd like to make a motion if we approve consideration, approve the placing limits on it.
Well, if you approve the resolution, you're good.
Okay. That's make a motion to approve the resolution as presented in our book.
And this is not time sensitive. Thank you.
I'll second that. We have an item number 20. We have a motion and a second. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All against? There are none. Passes 3-0. Item number 21. Board consideration and participation in a possible municipal. This is, I guess, Ken Gerardi.
Commissioner, I may.
What is this about?
It's in the book.
I know, but that's it.
I told you. Interesting.
Mr. Bell.
Keep going.
Has joined us.
He has.
At 2:53 p.m. This is your meeting now.
We'll keep going on this item until I get there.
Okay. I'm going to let Mr. Gruen explain this.
Mr. Gruen's going to handle this.
I'll explain this, please.
Commissioners, we've received three different notice letters in the mail concerning a $54.5 million fund created as a result of the out-of-court settlement between the various state's attorneys for a number of the states, and in this case, Wachovia Bank. This has to do with running parallel with an issue concerning municipal derivatives, price fixing, if you will. An antitrust suit has also been filed. This particular settlement here is just for the Attorney General, and they've sent us these notices offering to ask if we want to participate in this settlement. In particular, what this would mean to the county, two of the notices were addressed to the Board of Commissioners and Forsyth County Government. The third is addressed to the Water and Sewer Authority. The total dollar amount would come to $31,083.61, of which $4,490, that's for water and sewer. So the remaining $26,000 is for the Board of Commissioners. At this point, after reviewing the materials and other options and so on, I'm prepared to recommend that we go ahead and we ask the board to approve our submitting a positive response to these notice letters that we will participate in this settlement. It would be time sensitive as they're expecting a response to be postmarked no later than October 1st. So basically by participating in this, the county should receive $31,083.61.
So post marked by October?
By October 1st, right. There's two documents for each of these letters that we would have completed and signed and submitted before the appropriate date upon approval by the board.
And there's three release agreements in there as well. So when you make your motion, if you choose to, you need to call out the fact that you will authorize the chairman to execute the releases, because obviously if Wachovia or anybody else is going to pay us any money, they're going to want to release.
Any county manager sign this, or we have to have chair?
Chairman or county manager, I would prefer the chairman.
Prefer the chairman.
Yes.
And do we need to specify the amount in there, or just the agreements, because it's in the agreements?
The amount is specified in the backup that Mr. Grillen went through.
I guess we could reference accepting the offer to participate in the settlement based on the three notice letters received.
Commissioner Levan, it's in the release. The actual dollar figure is in the release.
So how do y'all do these like things one at a time, or just tell us we have three of them? How do you want to do
this? They're all related. So I think that if you authorize the chairman to execute the releases with respect to this out-of-court settlement between Wachovia Bank and various attorney generals, I think we'll be fine.
So moved.
Second. Is that adequate?
It is. I just want to make sure.
Time sensitive.
I would just like the clerk to note in the record, and that, Mr. Gruen, could you call out the three numbers just so the minutes reflect the exact dollars?
Amounts, yeah. Sure. The notice letter addressed to Forsyth County Board of Commissioners was offering a settlement of $10,958.74. The notice letter to Forsyth County Government was $15,634.60. And the notice letter address of Forsyth County Water and Sewage Authority is for $4,490.27.
Okay. We have a motion and a second on item number 21. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All against? There are none. It passes 4-0. Mr. Bell. Yeah. Commissioner Bell. Okay. We've had two items added to the end of the agenda, which we only have three votes to add, so we need a fourth if you are applying the vote for those.
Commissioner Belton, forgive me, Commissioner.
Yeah, and I'll read it to you, I guess, because then we'll be able to hand it back to you. Item number 26 of the time-sensitive item was Forsyth, Sony EMC, for an agreement for Post Road Library. If you're willing to add that to there. Item number 27 was also time sensitive. It had to do with the Oak Senior Living LLC, and it was an agreement to proceed at risk for sewer.
So the record can reflect that you sounded your confirmation. Thank you.
And then just if I could, Commissioner Levin, I'm just going to hit the ones that still need to be done. That would be 2, 3.
Yeah, I mean, I got more. You have to check off.
I got
trying to use that 2, 3
to start you off.
Yeah, 10. That would be correct.
13.
That's correct.
17.
Mm-hmm.
19.
I have 18. Oh, yeah, 19. Yes.
24.
That's correct.
25.
That's correct.
26 and 27.
Correct.
So, if it's okay with everyone here, we'll just go back to number 2 and then walk through it. All right.
Very good.
All right, thank you, Commissioners. On the agenda for today in our budget calendar is the presentation of the proposed fiscal year 2013 operating budget. And by presentation, I do not mean to go through the entire thing in detail, where this is the presentation to the board. This is now the proposed budget. We'll also have a public hearing on October 4th, at which time we can go through some more of these slides in the book we put together. And the scheduled adoption date is October 18th. If I may, just hit a few of the highlights today as far as what's in this budget, and if there's any questions, we can move on from there. First of all, not a lot has changed from what the board saw before in the budget, but I'll mention a few of the key things that staff has put into the proposed budget based on direction from the board when we gave the different items needed to be used to balance the budget. And some of those would be as follows. What is in the proposed budget now based on the direction given from the board previously, is the funding for the 401k program for the employees, which had been reduced back to 3% the last couple of years, is now in the proposed budget now up to the 4% level. And that means not just 1%, depending on the standing of the employee, that means for those where the county matches up to the percent, the county would match up to 4%. It also means employees beyond a three-year level get an outright 4%. So what this can mean, and then also employees beyond 10 years have another additional amount, but what this can mean is for employees that participate and are beyond 3 years, there would be an additional 2% into the 401k. I want to make that clear. It's not just a 1% difference. In addition to that, we have put in what we're just calling at this point in the salary lines for all the departments and offices is a 3% salary increase. We call it that because the board has not yet determined if it'll actually be a COLA or a merit raise, but there's dollars either way for a 3% increase in that. We have made the, what made those two possible really, what helped make those possible, we've adjusted the health insurance program based on the changes and initiatives placed in that. And other than that, we'll talk a little bit about the new capital fund budget. We've moved a number of the items that the board identified as replacement items to a new capital fund budget. And those are most of the things that have occurred since then. I think we've also added a position for the planning department to help with their workload for permits, and that's also included in this budget. With that, other than to highlight a few slides, before that, let me give one number for comparison on the total general fund. The proposed general fund budget is $89,600,134. The 2012 budget was $92,448,864. Now, straight up, that looks like a 3% decrease. However, I wanted to highlight that the reason why it appears that way is because certain funds have been moved into new funds and some other funds have come into the general fund. I wanted to give you a more probably correct comparison of really what the change in the budget would be. And that is if we add back in the insurance premium tax, which has been moved out to a new fund, as we're directed to account for that separately under the Georgia Code, if we add back in the grants that are being moved to a new grant fund, and if we take back out the impact of the internal service funds that were closed and those transfers coming into the general fund, the adjusted dollar amount would be more like $95.75 million, or the real increase is 3.6% increase in general fund budget as adjusted for those changes in the new funds. And I think that's probably the more appropriate comparison to fairly show that, or in other words, about $3.3 million increase, and that's all supported by revenues on the revenue side. All right, with that being said, we'll just go through most of these items quickly. Hold on, let me go back for just, beginning in general fund, just to highlight the sections of the general fund are divided into judicial system, which proposed budget is at $12,069,000. Total other general government is proposed at $17,264,000. Total public safety is at $37,837,933 up there in the right hand section of that. You see there's nothing here in the general fund for engineering. Where's John? Sorry about that. No, that has moved to another, the insurance premium tax fund. So that's still budgeted, just not right here in the general fund. That's one of the adjustments I wanted to make that comparison for.
SRF?
And, pardon?
What is SRF?
Special revenue fund. That's the type of fund it's been moved to. Also, total health and welfare, just over $2.3 million. In the general fund, total culture and recreation, $12.3 million. Total housing development, $4
million. Hold on just a minute.
Go ahead.
Mr. Moss, is that a movie starting?
No. There's not a rule against cell phones here, is there?
But it says to turn them off the door.
So,
oh, it does? Go ahead. I thought y'all were talking. Oh, okay.
It happens.
Yeah.
Put it vibrating. Silent.
So I just wanted to not sidetrack.
All right. Total transfers to other funds, just under $1.4 million. Here you'll see the transfer to the insurance premium fund of $1,199,000. That's how much the general fund still needs to subsidize that fund for engineering. The difference is made up by the insurance premium tax that we receive. So that still is connected to the general fund. So any increases or decreases to engineering still affect the general fund. and other financing sources such as Georgia Lease Pool and other miscellaneous items just under $800,000. And what we were able to do is to, when we balanced everything out, increase the contingency to just under $400,000. Last year it was $230,000, so we have a little bit more in contingency. And here we're showing the animal control contract separately that was previously shown in the sheriff's budget. So here we have the total general fund expenditures I mentioned earlier of $89.6 million as adjusted.
That animal control, is yes. That what goes to the Dr. Orr Center?
Exactly. That's the contract. Yeah. So when we have our own facility, that will no longer be there.
That shouldn't be a barrier.
Right. Right. That'll be no doubt be needed for operating expenses and so on for our own facility. Okay, here on the other side of the $89.6 million is all the revenues. The reason why you see there's a number of things in the tax section in the top included in here in the property taxes. Those are represent the tax digest being down to 2.22%. Sales tax is up about 4%. And the reason why this whole category is down is, again, because we took the insurance premium tax and moved that out. It's about $6.9 million to a separate fund. That's the main things really to, I think, highlight on there. And the fund is a proposed balanced budget. All right, just briefly, some of the other funds. The fire fund, which is a special revenue fund, it has its own tax source. That is balanced at just over $16.5 million for the various operations of the fire department down in here. Included in these areas is funding for a replacement fire truck at, I think, $650,000, as has been the annual plan from year to year, and is supported by the taxes we've been collecting for fire service. Other special revenue funds. Well, here's that shows the fire fund balanced. There is some use of fund balance, which is really what we've accumulated from the taxes in the last couple of years, and that's what's helping to pay for the fire truck replacement. Here's the new grant fund, which we moved to all the federal and state grants out of the general fund and a couple of the special revenue funds. This again is done to help account for better all the various grants, and this will enable us to do that, but not having commingled with other departments the way it has been in the past. Up here, the transfer from other funds, which is primarily from the general fund, is $1.1297 million. Shows you basically that the $1.1 million in match overall, not all these grants have specific matches, but brings in grants of just over $1,376,000, or a little more than half, is how much that we're leveraging, if you will, with those county dollars. Here's the new local insurance premium tax fund. You see up the top the $6.9 million from the insurance premium tax and one other small revenue that the department takes in, transfer from the general fund. And here's what used to appear in the general fund before: roads and bridges, general engineering, traffic engineering, and stormwater. I'll mention this before, but repeat again. One reason why we've lined these up with this revenue is this revenue is for us from the unincorporated part of the county, meaning the city gets their own share of the insurance premium tax. These are our road and bridge services for the unincorporated part of the county. The city has their own road transportation department. So this matches up an unincorporated revenue with unincorporated services, and that was important to do that. And again, the other reason why initially we needed to do this is because this tax, there are requirements to account for it separately, not commingling it with the general fund. So we've corrected that now, if you will. That's one new fund there. Some of the other special revenue funds, the large one here each year we get is the E911 fund for the operations in 911 center. And that comes from the surcharges, if you will, and the phone bills. Water and sewer fund is also going to balance budget at $43,850,000, which even including depreciation in the budget, which is a non-cash item, we still are able with this, at this funding level, this all comes in this level with these expenses and expenditures, we'll still add $4.2 million to the net assets of the utility. Solid Waste Recycling Fund, which handles the Keep Forsyth Beautiful and the recycling centers of the county, $1,815,000. The bonds, which are in particular, this is the funding that comes out of taxes, our bond tax rate for the 2004, which was just refinanced, and 2008 bonds. And the amount of taxes and commissions going towards these bonds is just under $7.5 million. Now this is the new not that the fund itself is new. We always had a capital fund to run expenditures through, but it was not previously a budgeted fund. That's optional for the county to, and a lot of governments do budget a capital fund. It's not a specific requirement in the state code. And I'll explain a little bit more about this, and we'll see something on this in the future agenda. The items, the replacement capital items that were moved out of the general fund, as of when this was prepared, was 1.6 million in items that were moved out of the general fund to be funded and budgeted for in this capital fund. I think we have a detailed slide. Oops. No, it'll be later on. Move back to where it was. There we go. What I'll be bringing forth to the board, we discussed with the Finance Committee earlier on the work session October 9th, will be a resolution that's been drafted along with the County Attorney's Office, which recommends a funding source to move a certain amount of dollars from the excess above the 25% reserve requirement in the general fund. We'll move those to this fund to be budgeted for replacement and capital purposes. So that will be the funding source. We'll have a resolution coming to the board on October 9th that will set up how that's done. And that is where the funds for that come from. And I think when we see the equipment list later, we'll see what some of these items are. I think that's later. Capital items, and most of these the board has seen before, not too much to highlight at this point. And these are mostly mostly the new items, since the replacement ones from the general fund were moved out. Special revenue funds, enterprise fund, water and sewer. And here's the capital fund. So you see the kind of things that were moved over here. Some of these are still in the process of looking to see. We did some paperwork processing in the engineering area where these may be able, we may be able to buy these out of the current year engineering budget. So we may not have to buy these out of this fund next year. A few items for Parks and Recs. The major item is the vehicles here, 20 vehicles for the Sheriff's Office at just under $1 million, and some computer equipment and software for the financial system. One other thing I want to mention, and by the way, both when it comes to the county financial policy adopted back in 2001, the financial policy, the financial policy of the board does provide for budgeting and providing for replacement capital items. So we're doing this in compliance with that, as well as we are also supposed to have a replacement program, which I just mentioned last Finance Committee. Our office has now started working on putting together a replacement program for all county capital and equipment. That's something important to see, because there's basically an annual expense to that going forward. And something I think we need to have for each year's budgeting purposes. That replacement program, I would expect to try to drop into this capital fund each year in the budget process, so the board can consider which items to replace or not replace as the funding allows.
Stay on that slide just for a minute.
Right back. There you go.
I know you got. Or do you want questions at the end?
You can. It's easier to ask them right here if you'd like.
The Chargers and the Crown Vicks and the Ford Taurus. Did we specify that those are patrol vehicles, marked vehicles?
I recall, I think we did in a committee meeting.
I just, sometimes I get forgotten, and I just want to make sure that's what we were doing.
That's on discussion. I recall is that they're supposed to, I think, all the patrol vehicles.
Yeah, I have a question for you on those. You've got 10 Dodge Chargers, 9 Crown Vicks, and 1 Taurus. Are Crown Vicks still available?
I don't know that's how they were submitted. I mean, if they're not, then they're going to have to, of course, go over to the other.
Go back to, we talked to Don about that.
Right. Ford is coming back out with, they're calling it a police interceptor. I'm not sure if it's coming out for next year, 2013. But the majority of ones they've been buying have been the patrol Caprices, and not the Chargers.
Right. Correct. The only reason why I look at that at all is I know they've had tremendous, I don't want to belittle anybody's cars, but they've had tremendous problems with their Dodges. It looks like the initial numbers coming out, the new Chevys are getting about 20 to 40% less gas mileage. So I don't know how many of those we want to load up and get stuck with that for all the years. And I have 100 of those running around. So the Fords, they come out with Crown Vicks, or are they going to be Tauruses or something?
They're going to be called a police interceptor.
It's basically
just a generic police interceptor.
The only thing I wanted to ensure is when we budgeted these, they were for the deputies that are in a car for 12 hours a day is what the intent was and what the request was for. Now we might want to talk to sheriff, that might change, I guess, how we handle that. That was the intent, that's the reason we're having so many.
There's probably going to come a time that we really ought to look at the completeness that every vehicle the sheriff's office has, equate it to how many vehicles are on a road at the busiest times of day. Look at the detectives on the seat. I think it's about 300 vehicles.
Yeah, 300 vehicles.
But yeah, there's less than 297 sort of. Officers, and I don't understand why it lays away.
We have to look at that, but I'm right now intent on getting the patrol vehicles replaced. They've got 200,000 miles on them. The seats are collapsed. The foam rubber's broken down and all that. These guys have been spending like 10, 12, 14 hours a day.
Just make sure they get them instead of command staff and stuff.
Exactly.
Well, I agree.
Yeah, last time around we bought patrol vehicles, but a lot of them were black.
Yeah, and they didn't go into, they didn't go to on the street.
Yeah, I just when we talked to the sheriff, we agreed to do this as long as they went for black and white cars with blue lights on top.
Right. One of the document you'll see, you've seen in the last couple of years, is a resolution. As part of the resolution for the budget, will be a requirement that the board approve the purchase of the vehicles if funding is available. So at that point, I would imagine you would also have some discretion at that point to make determination of what type of vehicles you'd like to purchase. So we'll make that part of the document as well.
That's good. Also, in the capital replacement program, we plan to address the total number of vehicles. Now, we'll look historically at the mileage. How they're signed and how they're used will be up to the person, the sheriff. So I think we do. That's a great example of how we need to address. If there's over 300 vehicles and we're only replacing 20 a year, the math doesn't work for how many years. We've got some catching up to do.
Ms. Cooper, did you say 2014 would be the new Ford police interceptors? Or?
I'm not positive, professional event. I don't believe it was 2013, but I will double check.
And certainly, a lot of times 14s come out early in the year, so we might want to consider holding out if they are a better vehicle.
Well, we just need to work with the new sheriff. Yeah. See that was an agreement we had with the sheriff, so even though it's discretionary, we agreed to fund them as long as he agreed to make them black and white. So,
gotcha.
That was, even though he has discretion, that was something that we negotiated.
After November election, we'll see.
But I'm still negotiating.
Right.
So,
Thank you.
Good. All right. Just briefly, some of the new budget items across the various offices and departments. Up the top there, just so the board knows that's still in the budget, is where we ended up with the funding for the cost related to the new third Superior Court judgeship. That's the funding that's included in this proposed budget. And we also have, I believe this was recommended by the library, is the first half year of operating costs for the Post Road Library at $178,100. Just note that is in the proposed budget. And here's the positions for planning and zoning to help deal with the workload that they've been facing with the increased number of permits they've been processing. And other funds, roads and bridges, fire department, and so on, internal service funds, water and sewer, solid waste. And that's it. There's the remaining dates on our calendar to continue moving along the budget process.
Dave, let me ask you, if I could, we received an email from the sheriff, our sheriff, and the sheriff, asking that we reduce his budget. I don't know if you got a copy of that. I guess the board needs to decide, and your input, Doug, your input, and the Surf County Attorney's input. What's the protocol?
One of the things I did see that email requesting a reduction of
law.
Requesting a reduction of, I think, just over $5 million in current preliminary budget, and now the one being presented to you today. Myself and Mr. Drew have talked about that. I recommend against reducing the budget by that amount. It might make more sense to park that money in a different fund if, in fact, you were going to, for the purposes of developing or completing development of the budget and adopting the budget, park those funds in another fund and allow the new sheriff to come in to evaluate his needs and then come back to the board to make budget adjustments at that point.
Do you want to go ahead and prepare that in the public hearing statements and count adjustment?
with the board's direction, we could take those funds from the sheriff's lines, if you will. I would recommend putting in, within general fund, which is balanced with its revenues, I would put in a reserve for public safety, reserve for sheriff, put that dollar amount there, and then, again, by action of the board, well, working with the new sheriff.
They may not have time until January or February to really dig into his budget, so.
And then we can certainly appropriate it back as the board wants.
I think that's a good idea.
I think it's a great idea.
So I'm going to move that into a reserve, and then we can reappropriate it.
That way it's available.
But is it two, is it three, is it four, is it 5 million?
Well, the sheriff today has requested a $5 million reduction, and I think that it's.
Yeah, but he really thought that was there. Why did?
Well, no. What I'm saying is we ought to just move that into that special fund, because we have to kind of. You know, he is a constitutional officer. We got to do it until December 31st, which is his budget. So I think we can move it into a fund, which is a safe way to do it.
We'll put it in reserve.
We don't want to take out budget.
No, just move it into.
We'll change the general fund budget. We'll put it in reserve and within the general fund from which the board can reappropriate back the sheriff's budget as it's worked out in the sheriff.
Excellent.
Okay?
Is that all right with everybody?
Yeah.
Yes.
So the funds would not be considered part of the sheriff's budget?
Correct.
Yeah. Just come ask for it, David.
No, we understand.
Good.
One of the other things that came up in the last couple of days, do you help with the term, do you help set the budget for all the courts? Do we need to look at some additional funding for security at probate court?
I don't help judge.
You don't help over there?
No.
The concern is that we only have security during court days, and then the other days it's completely open, and the DAs aren't there, and I'm just.
That is a concern that Judge Jordan has voiced many times.
Doesn't the sheriff handle that? Is that something they would sit down with the sheriff and
come into?
It's not
he,
much.
He's providing security on the days of court. So
you've got in the new sheriff's budget how many positions he has, and I think there's as many as 25 right now that are not filled. So should they fill those positions, certainly they've got some extra people that time to move around.
Yeah, how do we as a board let the probate court judge and the DA and all those employees that are over there, we take their you know, you think about the DA's prosecuting people, and then you got a family member that's a little upset that, you know, Uncle so-and-so or Aunt so-and-so's gone to jail and gonna just walk right in there and walk right down the hall.
Well, our job as commissioners is to make sure the budget allows them to have the personnel they need, which it does. It does. And we're giving them an avenue to come back and ask for $5 million more.
I don't know.
And that's between the sheriff, who's in charge with the courts and the jail.
There's legal responsibilities and there's moral and ethical responsibilities, and I think we have responsibilities for those employees too.
But we don't have the authority.
How do we ask the sheriff? Do we budget to the sheriff? How's that?
Well, typically you would anticipate, first of all, there'd be a courthouse security plan, which would identify all the avenues that the law enforcement branch would take to safeguard those in the prosecutorial and judiciary. Probate, I think, is a little bit different just because their space is different. I don't know if there's a separate plan for that space. I would assume there is. There's a program, there's
a
plan.
I didn't find out that there's no security except during the course of time. And, you know, you can't leave the chief prosecutor of the county unprotected.
I agree with you, but I don't know that that's our place to. That security set up by the sheriff and the judge, they work together on that. And you and I can walk through that building right now and find four, five, six deputies standing together. They just need to manage it better. It's not our job to do that.
What would you recommend? I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on it.
Well, you know what the definition of trying to line out of the sheriff's budget is. You know how successful that is. It's not very, it's very difficult to do.
Can we provide it, though? There's nothing in the law that prevents us from
providing
it. But then we're going to get into the Marshal protection, Sheriff?
No. We could perhaps fund the probate court with enough money to reimburse the sheriff's office for security, for example.
They've got enough money.
What about make that in form of request?
Can you?
You don't work with probate, Judge?
Not typically.
Do you work with DX?
Sometimes.
Would you reach out to them today and just call me or email me and see what we can do? I want to get that place addressed.
Well, certainly you can send a letter over to the sheriff and say this is more concerning, and would you consider assisting them?
Or, and if he says no,
then we need to take steps.
I think that, again, there's legal and technical requirements of the sheriff's
tools.
Right. For instance, like our DUI and drug court, we have a special fund where we pay off-duty deputies overtime, and it may be possible to do something like that if funds are allocated.
I'm not going to get into an argument like that. Now, the sheriff, you say, I'm not going to put a price on the deputy. It's like, well, it's kind of the same thing. If he won't fund it, then we need to figure out what to do. Because we're leaving a lot of people.
Are you recommending that we vote on sending a letter from the board to the sheriff asking for some assistance?
No.
I'm just going to let reach out. Just because she works with her more than we do, she's more familiar with that process. And then she can come back and let me know, and then I'll talk to you guys and talk to Karen.
Because the DA and Judge Jordan are there all the time.
I know they are.
And she'll have somebody. There's no doubt.
Thank you. Sorry, I didn't know. The passage just came up. Is there any other discussion on the budget? Is there any action you need?
This is just the official presentation, and we've got public hearing on October 4th.
Then we'll move to item number three, which is discussion of the compensation for the county court position. Director of Personnel Services.
Determine the compensation for the county coroner position for 2013. There is a be a new term for a new coroner. Previous salary, current salary for a coroner is $43,734.16. The current coroner has been in office for 12 years. The initial starting salary in 2000 was at $33,075. I've also included a compensation analysis from other neighboring counties regarding the same position. In addition to the guidelines for compensation for coroners in counties with population of 35,000 or more, in which they can be paid by either death investigation fees or additional compensation by local legislation. But either one, they would have to be compensated one way or another.
Is there any compensation now, or is this salary straight, 437? That was current salary for our current coroner, $43,700?
It's the current coroner is making $43,734.16.
Okay,
but
there's
no trip
fees.
No
additional fees. That's just a straight salary.
Yes, correct.
I think the county supplies them a vehicle, correct? Do they have?
That I'm not familiar with.
So that's why I don't think
I would suggest that we just adopt it where it's at, just leave it where it is, move on. But
Commissioners, I would like to add too that with respect to whatever we do with respect to the coroner's salary, that when the General Assembly meets, I would like, along with Ms. Carson, to approach the local delegation and ask that a local act be carried forward to go ahead and sort of nail this down by way of a local act applicable to our coroner.
Do we want a local act that authorizes the board to set it, or a local act that sets it?
Either one, but to the extent, I just would like a nice baseline put into a local piece of legislation. Unfortunately, I otherwise would bring it to you under home rule, but the Constitution doesn't allow that. I need my delegation to do it.
What would you recommend?
I think I'd recommend that we allow the local delegation to set the baseline with some inflation adjusters, and that way we have a nice clean way for Pat to bring the yearly salary.
Do you want a motion that affects
yes.
that?
Yes. Along with setting this, yes.
Fine, I would make a motion that we set the salary at $43,734.16 to carry forward, and additionally instruct the county attorney to work with the Director of Personnel Services to draft a resolution that sets a baseline for the coroner salary with some inflationary adjustments, et cetera, and perhaps even give the board authority for supplements if needed.
To present to the local delegation.
To present to the local delegation.
Thank you, sir. Second.
A motion and a second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed. That's 4-0, with Commissioner Crawford absent.
Thank you.
Thank you. On to item number 10, the adjournment.
Yes, sir. Huh? Mr. Commissioners, we're here today to give you an update of Eagle Beat Park. We have Reggie Hill here with us today to go over the plan of the park.
And to just kind of put it back in front of you to refresh everyone's memory of this property. It's on the Etowah River on Old Federal Road. The overall concept of the approved master plan stage for this park was for it to be a hobby park, if you will. We have multiple activities planned and programmed into this park, and I believe some of these activities are going to be discussed today on this agenda item. But within this, we have BMX track proposed and planned. The existing model aviation field is on this property. We have meadows that are slotted for archery as a use and just open field, open play area. We have nature trails proposed on this property, areas for primitive camping that could work with the local Boy Scouts and that type scenario. And we also have a canoe launch planned on the Etowah, which is a part of the Blue Way program. We've been proceeding with design, and the black and white 11 by 17 that was handed out is kind of where the site plan stands as we've worked through the design, worked through the grading of the property. Some of the parking lots got massaged a little bit to work it out. The overall plan for this park, though, is for it to be a passive hobby park and low impact in nature, with the roads and parking to be gravel in nature. There are restroom facilities proposed in the lower fields. There's a restroom facility proposed at the canoe launch area up on the river, and a restroom facility and a concession stand proposed up near the BMX track area to accommodate the BMX races and uses up there. Also proposed in this plan that I believe we'll touch on here in a little bit is also the preservation of the Sherrill House and fencing that. And so that was kind of a general brief overview of the property. I can answer any specific questions.
In that east field area, even though it's not shown yet, we have been approached by somebody that does, what was the model?
Correct.
Not us, them, the track or something.
And that's kind of the beauty of these lower fields, is that they are there and they're open space. We haven't really programmed anything hard defined in there just yet, so they're nice large open fields that these spaces could be used for
if the county commissioners, you know, see fit that, you know, it's a, an approach that they would like to take.
So the first item that we get an update on is the, what's that?
Are we still getting paid for the airplane?
Yeah, and we have a long-term lease because, Ken, correct me if I'm wrong, didn't we do a longer-term lease for them because they repaved the...
They did some improvements.
Yeah. So, and if they terminate, if we terminate them early, we have to reimburse them for the paving and something like that.
How long is that lease?
I don't know. It's a few more years.
Yeah, it wasn't terrible. I mean, it wasn't like 20 years. It was like 7 or 10 or something.
I think it was less than 5. I think it was around 5.
So this BMX, is this dirt bikes or is this...
Bicycles. No, this is bicycles.
Bicycles.
No motors.
Non-motorized.
They got pedals. We have been working, I think the county attorney's been working, Park and Rec, Tim Merritt has been working. Do we have a draft agreement you wanted to present on the BMX plan today?
Yes, sir. That's next.
That's coming next. Okay. The second one would be the archery club. Are we prepared to discuss that plan? Why don't we go ahead and cover that real quick, if that's okay.
Okay, the next one, like you say, is proposed MOU on the understanding between Forsyth County and Forsyth County BMX Corporation. We have Matt and the BMX Club here with us today.
Okay, you want to go ahead and take it?
Okay.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Commissioners. Matt Payton, this is Ryan Kramer from Forsyth County BMX. Ryan's going to cover a little bit about the MOU. It's a quid pro quo agreement. We're getting this for that. Ryan's going to talk a little bit about the Forsyth County BMX Club, the track overview, some economic impact, and then a little bit of the highlights of the MOU with what we would be asked for and then what Ryan and the group would be giving back to the county. So I'll let Ryan take over and try to make it as quick as possible.
Just to clarify, this has not been approved by the board or the county.
Correct. This is for your review and then legal review.
That is correct. The proposed agreement has not been to legal. This is simply
this is just a proposal.
Yes, sir.
If these improvements were made, when would it be operational?
I think he'd say as soon as we're signed, he'll get it.
Well, I don't know how quick the BMX can build this track.
I guess he can.
I just wonder, what does it do to the budget?
What does BMX do to the budget?
Yeah. These park improvements, are they going to be in the budget?
Are they just cost on
to operate us or not?
They operate.
They're operating.
They're going to take care of it.
They're going to cover it.
This won't be completed in 2013. It'll be 2014.
And they
it's built in 2013, and then we'll have to put it in budget 2014.
Okay. Your name again?
Ryan Kramer.
Go ahead.
I'm with Forsyth County BMS. Thank you, Commissioner Bell. Okay, so just real quickly, we'll talk about who we are, the tracks that we were suggesting and recommending that we build, the economic impact to the Forsyth County area, and our MOU overview. So just real briefly, these are the types of kids that race currently here within the state of Georgia, girls, boys, all ages, ages from 3 to 83, to be honest. So it's great sport, team sport, and individuals. And again, we are talking about bicycles here.
Pedals.
Yeah.
Pedals.
No motors, simply bicycles.
That's wonderful.
We'll work on the motocross track later. Not there, of course. So just about us real briefly, we filed for a 501c3. We are a nonprofit volunteer group. No one's paid. We're just parents and people who want to see this brought to the county. And you know, our mission is simply just to promote the new Olympic sport of bicycle racing here in Forsyth County. We actually have some local individuals who have been out to train for the Olympics in 2016 and 2020. So it's actually a pretty great sport. So the proposal is of two small facilities. One is the BMX track on the left-hand side. That's a track up in Knoxville. Just to give you an example, it's basically just jumps, turns, things of that nature. You'll just see the low-level lighting and a starting hill, which is the concrete piece on the left-hand side. Again, this is a facility that we're going to come in and build, and we're asking for a handful of pieces to help us get started, but for the most part, we're going to build, operate, and maintain this facility.
It's made out of dirt, isn't it?
It's clay. That's right. The corners that you see are paved in asphalt simply for maintenance purposes, and also for water control and drainage. The piece on the left, that is actually down at Big Creek Park in Roswell, Georgia. That is what's called a pump or skills track. That often is great for mountain bikers or people who want to start but want to take it easy on kind of a low-level practice facility. It's a great opportunity for kids to get started. I see lots of kids at the track in Roswell and also the track in Cherokee County. So this is just a quick look at the current tracks across the state and the southeast within our area. And everything in green, by nature, these are people coming into our county who want to come and race at our, would want to race at our local facility, and then, you know, cross-pollinate, if you will. You can see right now there is nothing in the north side of Atlanta. We would be the primary facility to serve all of Atlanta, northern Atlanta.
What would be a fee? I guess you're going to collect a fee?
We collect a fee only during race days, and that's to keep track of points and things like that. So a typical race is about $10. So we charge $2 for practice nights where we operate the facility and have people there. The facility would also be open 24 or during park hours for people who do not want to participate in our races. So we would continue to maintain the facility even for residents of the county.
Somebody just want to bring, get out the
Absolutely. Absolutely. So just a quick view on local economic impact. So from what we've seen in Peachtree City and other counties, by holding national, regional, and state level events, we expect a local impact somewhere between an additional $1 to $2 million of, you know, people coming to town to stay in hotels, visit our restaurants, visit our local retailers. And then also from just having a facility like this, it generates kind of revenue for our local businesses of around $100,000 to $250,000 additional revenue for, you know, bicycle shops and other retailers and restaurants just on a local, regular basis on a weekend, week out. Okay. So the MOU, so what we're asking in Forsyth County, obviously, you know, on the map, we've got about 3 acres that AMAC has allotted within the 225-acre space. We're asking for some sort of a ongoing land use agreement, which is consistent with some of the other facilities across the state. We're asking that the county provide dirt, and in this case, we actually, Matt has worked with Lafarge, who has agreed to provide the material at no cost. We just simply, once we have an agreement, we can go and find someone to help us truck it out there. Okay. As Reggie mentioned, the multi-use restroom and concession building need a place to sell goods and things like that for the day of the event. Obviously, a restroom would serve multiple uses, not just during the BMX, but also other park users. Eventually, the ability to provide low-level event lighting. So this is like tennis court lighting, so that we can hold, especially during the winter, this time of year, it gets dark pretty early, and also during the weekdays, so we give kids an after-school program to come out. And then obviously we need a way to have operating budget, and that's where the sponsorship comes in. We just would like the ability and the right to sell sponsorship out there. So what we're going to provide in return, we'll provide a weekly racing program for about 150 riders. We're going to provide the general insurance and name the county as a secondary insured. Obviously, we're going to do a lot of things to generate, give kids an opportunity to come out, drive for free, do free rider clinics, and even provide bicycles for kids who don't have bicycles or helmets or other things, come out and ride at no charge. So, and then the other piece, of course, is we want to provide revenue back to the county in the term of events or national or regional events. So the financials. So obviously we understand that you guys are providing us a lot. We want to provide something back in terms of revenue. So just as the RC group is doing, we've worked out a schedule where we can provide $1 per rider. And any fees that we collect for whether it's clinics or summer camps, vendor fees, things like that, we're going to provide a portion back to the county in exchange for their support.
Did you go through that with Jerry?
Yes.
Come up with that kind of based on what others are doing?
That's correct. This is consistent with Peachtree City and some of the other tracks around the area. Absolutely.
What do you go through the park board and the park committee?
Yeah, okay.
What do you anticipate bringing back to the county? In the percentage here, what do you think? First year, second year, what do you think you bring?
First year, if we get, depending on what time of year we get started, obviously, but the idea is that
about your first full year.
First full year, 150 riders on average per week. So probably somewhere between, on an annual basis, somewhere between 5 and 10,000 per year.
Back to the park budget.
Back to the park budget, that's correct.
Plus 150 plus riders 7 days a week?
No, it would be once per week.
Plus whatever revenues from
the and services. Obviously with national or regional events, we see a larger amount of riders. We see typically somewhere between 250 to 400 riders.
Do we have enough parking spots out here to accommodate a national event?
With the lower level overflow parking that would be on grass, kind of the that, yes, you would.
Could use the field as temporary parking.
That's correct, yeah. Yeah, and we would obviously, we would collect a fee for them to park and give a percentage of that back to you.
And there's trails connecting the lower fields to the upper.
Do you want to talk about the opening promotion where Commissioner Tam and Bell have a first ride race?
Absolutely.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
Yeah,
we'd love that.
How about all five? All current and former commissioners can go out there and race.
You know what, I have to tell you, that would be awesome. You're right, that would be quite humorous for the
very long. You've never seen anything like that. Car races down there, or mayor and all of them.
We'll certainly entertain that.
Get you some attention. I'm sorry, Ken, were you feeling left out?
No, sir, I don't know. I'll do it. I
do it once.
Is there safety concerns, I mean, with adults that maybe ride? I know down at the skate park, we had some issues with. It really wasn't the children.
Oh, you mean adults down there?
Yeah.
There are quite a number of adults who race. Everybody, you know, there's quite a number over. Typically, it's when their son or daughter is kind of in that 8 to 10-year-old range, so the parent is somewhere in the 35 to 45-year-old range, we see a resurgence where they come back to the sport and race. So, actually, there's quite a high number of adults.
I think the question is, it's not going to be open for people to go down there and just hang around and create trouble. I think it's more.
I understand.
You guys will police
hard to draw that type of crowd. That's what.
Yeah, I'm just worried.
I don't think it does.
There's a different crowd between racing and freestyle or dirt jumping. It is a different crowd.
But you would police it, and we could put into the MOU, given that they would.
Yeah, I mean, we have many of our board members are nearby within that property. We plan to be out there at least twice a week during the season. We also plan to install, if approved, some sort of a constant webcam so that we can kind of monitor the property and other people can see that. So at least provide some exposure.
Will people be able to use it when you're not there?
Yes, sir.
So
it will be open to people?
That was the recommendation that the rec board and the committee.
Rules for helmets.
They race on Sundays, so other than race day, it's open.
That's correct.
To the general public.
And have you seen any trouble down the roster with any of these other facilities?
I have not. I've taken my children to the one Noonday Creek down in Cobb County area, and
we can always evaluate if there ends up being trouble. We just have to.
We all monitor the webcam 16 hours a day or something. We all monitor it all the time.
Well, I mean, we'll. I don't know that somebody's sitting in front of it 8 hours a day, but
most of
it. I would say that we do plan to check it on a regular basis if we start to see some changes in behavior. Obviously, we would maybe work with.
I think that the way to address it is it gets to be a problem. Yeah. Reported out there, either through residents out there or other users, that comes back through the parking rack, but then there have to be some type of.
Are we going to have a general gate on this?
We're going to close at sundown.
Are we going to close and have general gates close at sundown? Is it going to just leave open? Sure.
We'll close at dark. If they have daylight hours only, then we can lock the gates at night.
Okay.
There'll be, I guess, for liability assumption agreement, but you have a minimum pads, knees, elbows, helmets required.
Yeah, we require helmets. We require long sleeve shirt, long pants.
We'll supply the sign.
That their insurance company.
That is correct.
Requires all that.
I'm sorry.
That your insurance company will require all that.
Yeah, they do.
Much more than we.
That is correct. And we are sanctioned under USA BMX, who's a nonprofit, the national organization body for all BMX cycling across the country.
And if you have a nighttime event, then it would be open right here. If it's a Friday night.
That's another issue too, the lights within the budget. We got $1 million budget out there to build these facilities, and I guess we have to put our priorities down how we're going to bid this thing out. Restrooms, parking lots, canoe launch, I think the canoe lots and parking lots and the restrooms are number one priority. Then we'll come back with
lights,
or whatever. So it may not be in phase one, but we'll have alternates.
How much are those lights, Jerry, roughly?
To light 3 acres could be quite a bit.
What would you think? I'm not asking for a quote. Is it $50,000?
It's going to be more than that.
So for the first year or two, it might be daytime.
And in some cases, the local authority like Sony has actually donated the lights in exchange for
sponsorship or something.
Right, that's correct. That's what Peachtree City did.
So if we just understand it.
And that's something that you could work towards, or it could just, you know, as the track moves on, work towards getting lights put up.
We will go ahead, though, and design the electrical system for the lights
as
part of the infrastructure we'll put in the cars.
To bring in a national event, it's kind of part of the...
Okay. Any other questions?
Just a question or comment on the, I know Advanced Disposal just asked to dig that 40-foot, 77-acre hole. Have they got everything, all that dirt taken, or could some of that be dirt used across the road for that?
No, the farmers already donated it. And I don't think, I talked to Advanced, and that's needed to maintain their coverage.
Okay. And as far as the dirt goes, we'll be able to generate some of your needs on site with this as well. Where the track is located, there's going to need to be some grading done to work it into as a downhill slope track.
Let's go ahead and move to the archery club. Thank you very much. Is there anything you need us to do on this particular one, Tim, Jerry? Y'all still working through it?
We just like a conceptual approval of this. We'll then, with your conceptual approval, we'll ask legal to review the document, prepare to come back to y'all for final approval.
Okay, that's fair. Is that good enough?
Yes. You guys conceptual approval of the BMX or the whole park?
Well, just
BMX.
Look for the agreement.
So yes.
And then that brings back to final.
Okay. The next MOU is about the Archer Club. We got Tommy and Anna here with the explain the MOU. Y'all have a copy of the package of the MOU with Archer Club.
Who's here to present for our new
MOU? Thank you, Commissioners. Archery couldn't be here today. We're still working on the draft with the Archery Club. The Archery Club is part of a 4-H group. We have been working with them close to 10 years now. We've been providing a space. They have been shooting at Ducktown is where they practice in the, I think it's one afternoon a week. They're up to about 120 members now of the youth archery group. So they pretty much outgrown that area. They're meeting with the state 4-H to find out about signing one of the problems, if they could sign a legal document with the county. They're working on that. So some of what I gave you, Anna with the Chamber of Commerce has been working with us. They came up, this is a list of all the potential tournaments, national, local, and state regional tournaments that's out there that's possible to, that we could bid on. One of the main objectives of the archery club, at the Eagles Beak Archery Park, it'll allow them to meet ADA accessibility standards and create programs benefiting all Forsyth County residents, including those with disabilities. They could extend services sanctioned by the International Blind Sports Association and the United Foundation for Disabled Archers. Big thing with the archery club, they work real close with DNR. DNR has some good grants. I know Eastern Era Company, the Eastern Company, they have some large grants also. The archery club is working with them now, trying to get some grants for the future. Basically the MOU is we're pretty much going along with the BMX track, most of the stuff. But they will, some of the main things that the archery club, they're going to schedule and host archer lessons to new residents, people that not sure if they want to get into archery before joining the club. They'll provide a grant program for underprivileged kids to allow youth archers and their families access to the archery club practice and lessons. Work with IBSA to create archery programs for area residents who are visually impaired. Work with the UFFDA to create archery programs for area residents who have similar manners of disabilities. Along with this, they're looking at 3D archery range, which will be part of the walking trail, but Reggie and them are designing it so that when we have 3D archery tournaments, they can close the trail off. It'll be closed off except for the archers to hold that tournament. They reroute the trail for the walkers. They want to help maintain the archery range, keep them in good repair, clean from trash and debris. They're going to construct the archery stands, the 3D and field targets, and try to get funding from the DNR for the 3D archery range. That is the big thing with DNR. Some of the main responsibilities that we're still going over is, cutting the grass, taking care of the areas in question. But
this is a part of 4-H. That's part of a state organization.
Right. 4-H. And when we started out, it was just basically a small archery club stuff, but. As talking with Anna Chamber and other, we've looked at moving to the front field that we can. It's big enough to host the international and national tournaments. I think it'd be something really good for the community as a whole.
So you'll just keep working towards getting that final.
We're working. I talked to the group yesterday, so we're trying to get the, all
just
of them.
To bring that back to the future.
Would you like to do that, or would you like to give us permission once we get a good contract, go ahead and work with legal on that, and then bring it back to you for final approval?
I think so.
Yeah.
I think so.
And they've already been working with the county for 10 years, so it's not like it's
new. We're out of space at Ducktown, didn't you?
We're pretty much out of space.
Work with Jerry, Tim, and Reggie, and get it to the county attorney as far as the agreement goes, and bring back the plan and the agreement. Okay. And then the last thing is Tim Merritt, and there's the Cheryl House agreement.
Yes, sir.
Ken, you want to go over that?
I do. Commissioners, this is, I guess, just the third component of what we're going on with respect to the Eagles Beak property. This was brought to me to basically do two things. Number one was to set forth an up to a 5-year license agreement for the Forsyth County Historical Society to have a 5-year license for this property to be able to conduct renovation activities at the Cheryl House, which is apparently a house located on the property that has some historical significance and of which the society has expressed an interest in trying to preserve and maintain. The agreement in front of you basically walks through the parameters of that license that would allow them to get on the property. They would be enabled to construct remedial renovation activities on this house. And then at the end of that 5-year period, or earlier, if they finished the work earlier, they would be able to approach the county and ask that we enter into up to a 10-year lease for them to be able to effectively lease the boundary of the property comprising the house and to use that property for historical activities, visitation by members of the public, etc. They can have their materials there, and otherwise it would be an improvement of a historical nature to the property. Now, a couple things to bring to your attention. Number one is that an agreement to enter into in a future lease is an agreement to agree in the future. So that's a little bit of a stretch. So what that says, how that would be interpreted is that when they come to us in 3, 4, or 5 years and basically say the work's done, we'd like you to enter into a lease with us now, the board in existence at that time will have to enter into the lease with them. We can't just sign it because you agree to that now.
Can we not construe it as perhaps a 15 or 20 year lease now that would terminate if they don't perform the work in 5 years?
We could. The thing I was struggling with, though, is that I've got to figure out consideration for the lease. And the consideration for the lease was the amount they're going to spend on renovating a structure on our property.
Exactly. But what I don't want to do, and I want us to be very careful of, is they're going to have to receive grants that are going to have restrictions on them. They're going to put a lot of time, effort, and money into this project. And I would not be comfortable, if I were on their board or sitting here today, granting them 5 years to go do all this work on without knowing that there's some longevity. You know, they're working with the Trail of Tears Association, for example, to put a facility there. There's a trail, you know, a roadside monument that they want to put there because there's some significant Vans Tavern was out there, significant Native American activities. Yeah. So what I'd like to ask is if we feel comfortable with a lease that's a long-term lease that terminates if they don't perform within 5 years. So that way it's not really binding a future board. It's not saying that a future board is going to lease something to them. We're going to go and lease it to them, but it terminates them if they don't perform. And I think that would fall under the allowable activities of this board.
You'll just have to be cautious in how you list what is performance and what is not.
Well, it'd be the same thing as they have here, that they would they have to put value at or approaching $100,000 in renovations in it. So if they don't do that within 5 years, the lease terminates versus having to come ask for a new
one. What do you do? Require them to show your receipts and stuff?
Sure, they're going to have to do that anyway. They're a nonprofit, so.
Let me be clear what I was doing with that language. And this was, Commissioner Bell, I should have explained this further. That whereas statement was declaring that the amount of work they're going to be, the value is not approaching 100,000. And the reason I put it in there was because if it triggers 100,000, it's subject to the public works procurement laws. And I don't want us near there. And that's my understanding is it won't approach that. But no, I can reconfigure it. Right now it's 5 year lease coupled with 10 or 5 year license coupled with 10 year lease. If you all want me to go back and make it a 15 year lease, I can. The consideration is still going to have to be them doing the work.
Can a future board rescind the lease?
The way this is drafted now, the future board can rescind it, and they can rescind it. They may want to get out of it.
Well, any lease can be terminated by either party, but I don't want them to have to go out there and do all this work and commit to grant dollars and commit to the Trail of Tears and commit to other organizations, not knowing
their future.
Their future. I said, that wouldn't be fair to them. So what I would rather do is say that this board recognizes the importance of what they're doing, preserving one of the few homes left in this county. From the 1800s, early 1800s. But if they don't perform, it terminates. So they have to perform for the lease to continue. If they don't, it goes away.
What if they have a hard time of doing anything? How much are we going to call for termination? If they spend $5,000, $6,000?
We would have to say, I think, Tim, we talked about that within 5 years, it would have to be substantially restored, right?
Yes, sir. Uh-huh. Yes, sir. I would expect it to be substantial.
It's hard to get money right now.
Yeah, but 5 years is fair. I'm not saying.
So we're gonna say substantially restore.
5 years.
I mean, yeah, not have money amount on it, but say.
No, that we have to have some specific that's fair to the county and the taxpayers. It can't be that they come in and say we're working on it. No, it has to be well underway, 75% complete, 80, 60, whatever.
5 years is plenty of time to do that.
I agree with you, but maybe we'll put some kind of cost or some kind of.
What do you think the specific would be, Ken? 75% complete?
In 5 years?
80%?
Well, I mean, this anticipated it to be finished in 5 years.
So 100%.
This is anticipated to be done.
So the renovations have to be complete and open for business.
Yeah, instead of putting the money date, it has to be 100% complete?
100% complete and ready for our citizens to utilize it, to benefit from it.
It might be $25,000.
And if they get through sooner, that's fine.
Commissioners, I would like to add to this document, if I could please. This is a GIS originated document, which shows the outline of the property. This potentially would be fenced in. You'll notice that the bottom edge of this is a little
unusual shape. That is such that it would fit into the master plan of the park, the trails, the sidewalks, and such that the visitors here could use the parking provided by the BMX course. So it's kind of a shared location. Restrooms could be shared. That's right. So I'll pass that around, and if you would leave that with Cindy for the.
Are we going to go ahead and build the fence, chain the fence or something now?
Yes, sir. As part of the park, we would be doing that chain link fence, yes, sir. And that would provide the security for the Sherrill House.
What about an option where if we want to come back in and take over the property, that we have to reimburse them for the amount that they have added in value to the property? Would that give the board any heartburn?
Well, if we terminate the lease without cause, I think we should do that anyway.
Yeah. That's it. Fair. That's right. Yes.
I think that's reasonable. Okay.
That's good.
That simply perfects a future board's entitlement. If they want some new master plan and want to take the whole house down, that's fine, but we got to pay the reasonable value for whatever the upgrade you've done.
Yeah, fair enough. So 20 years, 5 years, 100% completion, termination by either party at any time, can be termination without cause, they reimburse what they have extended.
You want to put a cap on that?
No damages or no future.
The cap's 100,000.
They can't go over 100,000.
That's their own personal, that's their own cap. So, yeah. It's not what they want to spend. It's up to them.
In addition to that, sweat equity, there's no way for them to benefit.
No, we're not faced with equity and things like that. We only pay
documents.
Verify money. Like when you're seized.
I understand.
Do you need that in the form of a motion, or do you just going to bring it back for?
I need to bring it back, y'all. Yeah, that's a fairly significant change.
All right. Is there anything else on any of those items that I want to discuss?
I don't believe so.
Just before that takes a long time.
Yeah, because we got people paying for our stuff. We don't have a taxpayer space. Number 13, please.
Thank you.
Yeah, we appreciate our turn.
Alright, number 13.
Sorry.
Oh.
Start this one. Yeah, do you want me to do this one or at least start it?
Please. So we'll start out.
Excuse me.
We'll start out a little bit. If there's any questions or such.
And shut my notes. The topic was our alcohol code. The topic was the alcohol code, and the issue was was brew pubs. And I know that I don't need to tell you this, but it just seems like the topic of alcohol is a recurring theme in the county. And whether it be wine tasting or growlers or brew pubs or the various things we've had to deal with, and I think that some of you and I have had some discussions about this. Yeah. I think the reason is...
Let me just toss it out. It's a good time to do it when we move on to this, because I think this needs to move forward. But one of the things that we have talked about, I think after this is in the process, because if indeed the board's going to do it, we want these people to go to the business role. But I think we've done so many modifications to the alcohol code, and there's so many exclusions and things of this nature. And talking with staff on trying to monitor it and keep up with revisions and things that we need to kind of dig in and redo it in its entirety.
Really?
Simplify it, streamline it,
located.
I'd like to ask if we could give the county attorney some direction to kind of investigate that and see what it could take to do that.
Let's get through this. And
well, then we'll move on to this because I want this to continue.
Yep.
So if that's okay, is that all right? You guys are going to do that?
Yeah.
Thank you, Ken. You'll do that?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. I'm sorry, go ahead on this.
The issue was brew pubs. Presently, our code really is silent on the issue of brew pubs, and we all know what we mean by brew pubs. We mean typically a vendor that has on-premises consumption, like a restaurant, that also brews their own malt beverages or beer on-site. They typically will sell it to, obviously, their patrons, but also under Georgia law, they can even sell it to wholesalers who can then sell it to other vendors as well. Our code really doesn't speak to it, and now we have a vendor that wants to do that sort of a model. And just like growlers and wine tasting, we have to come back to you because our code just doesn't anticipate that sort of thing. So what I've done, and Tom and I have worked on this, is we put together sort of a compendium of what the state regulations are on brew pubs. They do allow it. And they allow a brew pub to manufacture not more than 10,000 barrels of beer in a calendar year. They can sell them where they are sold, where obviously the beer is produced to their customers. And then they can sell up to 5,000 barrels annually.
Ken, one question. What's this discount money? What's a barrel consider?
I was going to say,
about 30 barrel? Gallons.
31. How much?
31 gallons.
31 gallons. 31 gallon. Okay. So 31 gallon barrel.
It's a keg.
Yeah. It's a big keg. A barrel is two of the big kegs. So when you think of kegs, yeah, those are considered half barrels.
It's a half barrel.
Typically.
Is four?
Times two.
So a pony keg would be four.
Four, exactly. Yep.
So do you need to note as a 31 gallon barrel, or do we just, is it general knowledge as in things?
I knew that. I can't believe anybody had a question about
that. Well, that's because you put together this compendium.
Tennessee.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. A U.S. barrel is considered 31 gallons.
Is that a standard?
That's a standard.
Code?
Is that measurements.
Signed somewhere?
It's a measurement for manufacturing across the board. Yep.
I didn't know that. I didn't either.
So the federal government, my equipment is measured on barrels as a measurement of volume. So I measure 3 barrels as my size of brewing tank.
Can't with all the information. Yes, I think Ryan knew it, being a restaurateur or a rack-up.
Basically, you know, the state law is fairly accommodating for brew pubs. Our alcohol code is not. That's the takeaway from this. We really don't allow it, or, well, that's not fair. We don't speak to it. That's a better way of saying it. Our code really doesn't speak to it. So the question I have for you is would you like us to modify our code to specifically, basically embrace state law?
Are these similar to like a John Harvard's or
yes.
or
on a smaller scale
or hops or something
yes.
like
on
that?
A small scale
and Rock Bottom that's down so, in Atlanta.
I mean those things have been around and then I think the hops is closed but there was one right over the county line over again the Sperry there. So that's nothing.
I think the whole sale.
It was either in the city of Angie County.
I think that the question here, though, is not necessarily are they going to brew their own beer, but can they wholesale it?
Yeah.
I think that's where
they
go.
Lucky. Okay.
Wholesale is a difference.
I don't know if Lucky had ever.
No, state law was changed. That wasn't in place when that got started. You know.
So this will turn into a growler type situation?
No.
You'll sell to other restaurants?
No, the state does not provide for growlers right now. That's why you all just enacted putting these growler stores in. Because in all the other states in the United States, you can walk into the brewery, you can walk into a bar, fill up your jug, and everywhere. Except in Georgia.
You will sell growlers.
Cannot.
No, you cannot.
Growlers go against the three-tier distribution system that the state has in place.
What is the wholesale?
They can sell to the...
You want a wholesale,
correct?
Right. Who will you wholesale to?
A distributor.
Would a local distributor sell it in a growler or sell it in a restaurant? Or
no,
a distributor that would sell it to a local growler shop or a local restaurant.
Okay, so you'll wholesale it to
all manufactured product into the state of Georgia has to be sold through a distributor to an outlet.
And then the outlet could either be an on-site they're selling it at their restaurant or bar, or they're selling it as in the growler, whatever their license allows.
Yes.
So you would sell half barrels to, say, United or Empire? Or
we've got to designate what distributor we want because of the way the laws are and all this stuff set up. The territory.
Sure.
We want to go find an aggressive young group that has statewide versus just certain little pockets, regional type of thing, because of the old boys that set it all up originally. You know, Coors here, Miller Lite there, and this one can sell you this and not that. You know, I mean, we've been dealing with it for 27 years, you know. But so we want to find an aggressive young company that wants to go out and promote the spirit.
What's going on right now, like I was, you know, sharing with Todd, was the growler shop that has all been approved here is getting beer from Atlanta instead of beer from Forsyth. Mm-hmm. We want to take Forsyth beer back to Atlanta because everything's sucking up this way.
So they can wholesale their
the growler shop
stuff up here.
Yes, yep. Because they've got the laws in place in Fulton County and
in Savannah, there's a brew pub called Moon River Brewing down in Savannah that's been doing distribution for so many years. And we had met the head brewer about 3 years ago, and he said all the local bars around their brew pub have their beer. And it's to create the local scene.
And that's what we want.
Red Brick, that had a similar situation.
Yes, Red Brick was similar. They had something similar on their old place in downtown.
I remember.
No, it's a lager.
Thanks a lot, Patrick. What do we need to do, Ken, for this?
If you want us to move forward to allow basically the full extent of state law to be embraced in our code, which is not right now, you just need to give me direction to work with Mr. Brown's office and bring back a proposed modification to the alcohol code that would embrace state law.
How soon would they get to be in business if we did this? We had 3 months, 6 months?
They will be in business as a brew pub.
They just can't wholesale,
and they can't reach the volume limits that the state recently expanded.
So, but when? How long would it take us to do this? What's our problem?
Take us 60 to 90 days.
Does this address alcohol content?
It does on the back. I mean, our code defines beer as with an alcohol content of up to 6%. And the state law is much more accommodating, all the way up to 14%.
Basically, we're just looking to align ourselves with state
That's
law
right.
all the way through to make this simple.
That's right.
Can you do that, Counselor?
Please. I can do that.
Thank you.
Do you need a motion?
I would like a motion when you tell me to go to
the Make a motion that you, under the state brew pub regulations, that you draft for new ordinance for our county that align with the state laws.
Yes, sir.
What about state law on growlers, the type of container used? Forsyth currently just allows a growler to be a glass container, but the state recognizes it to be any container.
How do y'all feel about that? You want to add to the motion?
I thought growlers for glass to sanitation purposes too.
Stainless steel and plastic can also be sanitized the same way as glass.
We're not authorizing it. We're not responsible for it.
Yeah.
We can add. When we're realigning and redrafting, maybe you'll consider that while you're getting everything cleaner.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, because when I bring this back to you, if you guys want to tell me to go and tweak a little further on growlers, that's fine.
Well, what we need to get this moving is as quickly as possible. But I think the other thing is to go ahead and start looking at a complete revision to the alcohol code to clarify some of these things and just make it easier to comply with them. Thank you.
No need to confuse us.
So we've got a motion and a second. Yeah. Vote on motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
This is 4-0.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Secret meeting. Next item. 17. Mr. Item 17. There's a document that's being passed around for your review. I apologize, you have not seen this to date. This is something that was perfected today, if you will. And this is a proposed agreement between Evans Consulting and Forsyth County. Eves Consulting and Forsyth County. Primarily the purpose of this agreement is to provide the county consulting service deliverables for the county local option sales tax negotiations with the city of Cumming. I'm not going to read all the terms and deliverables. You've got those in front of you, but in general, they will analyze all of the relevant factors that can be used to develop an allocation formula for the local option sales tax. And this includes review of the 8 criteria that you've heard us talk about before in this room. And they will certainly refer to those and reference those
and use those as criteria in the report. They will also inform and analyze tax digest for tax equity issues and prepare a calculation that will help determine the balance and equity of distribution of and of the funds, of lost funds. And six, Eves will review the current service delivery strategy between the county and the city. You've certainly referred to it before as SDS. And they will also advise the county on potential issues and negotiation strategies related to the SDS. And as we talked about before, lost and SDS go hand in hand. And we'll be discussing those along the way as well, as we have in the past. Eves will also prepare a combination of population digest, expenditures, equity, and tax burden data, and provide a composite recommendation with a potential distribution formula. You may recall that staff in the past has run numbers, collected data, compiled information, analyzed numbers, but we haven't really come to you and made a recommendation or provided a position report. We've just provided some information in some reports in the past. With this consultant on board, they would compile that information, gather that data, analyze it, and provide a position report, if you will, using that data. And then eight, Eves will prepare a comprehensive report detailing the findings of the items 1 through 7 and provide a presentation of such findings to the county. That presentation is entirely up to the boards. That might be something you want to see in writing, and that might be something you want to see or hear in the opening of the mediation. That's entirely up to the board, but the report will be prepared, and then the consultant can then bring that information forward in a format you see fit. Just a couple other things. With respect to the payment terms, items 1 through 7 or 1 through 8 that I just went over, the county shall pay Eves Consulting Group a total not to exceed $8,000 for the mediation, arbitration, preparation services as listed above. Those are the services that I went over just a minute ago. Travel expenses and printed material are billed separately. And the fee listed above includes all services up to including delivery of the final report to the county senior staff and county attorney. And of course, when we get that report, that's a report that will be distributed to the board for review as well. There are add-on services if the board chooses to use Eves Consulting to participate in mediation, as I alluded to a minute ago, to perhaps present their findings during mediation, then there would be an add-on cost for those services as well. They have agreed, consulting has agreed with respect to scheduling and timing, that once they're provided with a notice proceed, that they would be able to compile, analyze, and present a report to my office within 2 weeks.
Councilor, do you have anything?
Well, just that with respect to lost and the work product of this consultant, this is information that the county will use for purposes of the mediation, but will also use for purposes of, if we get to that point, the baseball arbitration, which is specifically anticipated under the lost law. This is information that I need to be able to handle the legal affairs of the county for purposes of tendering information to court to support the county's position. And until such time as litigation is over, this information is considered work product. I need this information to run my case. So I just say that to you to suggest to you that whatever information is ultimately distributed to you, I would ask that it be kept as confidential as you can keep it, because this will underpin our entire litigation posture if we go to baseball arbitration.
So Doug, is the total amount not to exceed $8,000, but is he going to bill us hourly, or what's he?
The $8,000 is for the initial report that will be prepared within 2 weeks.
Okay.
In my agenda request, I've plugged in amount requested of $12,000. Under professional management services, there's an amount available of $148,000. I've asked for $12,000 because I'm sure there will be some documents, printing, travel, and such that will be in addition to the $8,000 that is for the report itself.
I'd like to make a motion if everybody's willing. We good?
Any other questions?
I'll make a motion that we approve the agreement with consulting and Bruce Consulting, and that the amount doesn't exceed $12,000, and this item is time sensitive.
Thank you.
Second. Motion and second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. Passes 4-0 with Commissioner Vaughn. Somewhere you got a hold of it. 19.
Is this the Nancy Reagan Drive issue?
Yes,
it sure is.
All right.
You know, this is the product of a lot of negotiations that was going on, quite frankly, a long time ago, involving this access road to the back of the Tharrelson property off of Nancy Reagan Drive. It is an issue, quite frankly, that I think that one property owner, particularly Tharrelson, was concerned that if Nancy Reagan Drive was not a county road, that they would not have the free and unfettered access that they needed. On the other hand, the Taubman Corporation was just as adamant that they wanted that to be a private road that they could maintain and secure and ensure was kept in a nice, aesthetically attractive manner. And so the county was sort of embroiled in mediating this dispute between Tharrelson and Taubman. My understanding is, based upon the information I've received, even as late as today, there's really no issue anymore. I've heard that quite frankly, the piece on the back, we called it the Arrowhead piece. Does everybody understand what I'm talking about when I say the Arrowhead piece? My understanding is there's actually been an acquisition whereby this company called Gipper has actually acquired that from Tharrelson. And so my understanding is that Tharrelson has withdrawn any objections to whether that road is public or private.
Just to clarify, this is on the agenda, not at the request of Tharrelson or Gipper or... it's just cleaned it up.
This is something that had been on the agenda for a long time, where the county had been sort of taking a, we're going to set back and see if everybody can get this worked out. So they have.
What action do you need?
I think we need to have it withdrawn from the agenda, is my request.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a
second?
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Thank you. 4-0 with Commissioner Bonkley absent. That moves us to item 24, please. That would be Mr. Perkins, I guess, or Barry? I'm on the wrong one at the time. Sorry, I was looking at the one above it. You got to be on the right agenda. That's critical.
You do. I understand.
Sometimes you see what you like yourself.
Yeah, That's not that smart.
He reads a lot.
He reads a whole lot. Saying in your mind.
Very good.
Did that make a little plastic bag stuff?
Junior.
Did you get your red brick in?
I don't know if they did a little demonstration with a short talk about.
You ready?
I am, sir.
Tom, you ready?
Sam, thanks. Board members, on this next agenda item, I'd ask you to give me a little bit of leave to help explain some of this. And I'm certainly mindful that I have brought this to your attention before. Tom and I were here at a previous meeting talking about these issues of vested rights under our code. The background is this. We get requests all the time by applicants and members of the development community and even individuals to make decisions as to whether they have various vested rights under law, which is obviously well-recognized and well-established finding of law in Georgia, to do various things based upon performance standards and parts of our UDC that may in fact not exist anymore. And one of the ones we're really hearing a lot of feedback on right now, I think, is we're seeing some development activity pick up in the county, pertains to these old performance standards under Res 3. Under Res 3, we used to allow 9,000 square foot lots, and now we require lots of 14,500 square feet. And that change occurred in November of 2007. And we have had a lot of folks that have come to us and said, "Dear Mr. Brown, in 2006, we received a zoning for Res 3 that allowed this particular concept plan or site plan. We took this action, we expended this amount of money, but we never finished the development, and now all of a sudden you all changed the code in 2007. Now we're coming in for a site plan. Do we have the ability to proceed under the code as it existed when we were zoned, or do we have to proceed under the code now? Because if you proceed under the code now, we're going to have to throw away our zoning site plan. We're going to have to reconfigure, throw away all of the engineering work that we had done, throw away all of the previous money we had spent, and start over." And so we get that dropped on our lap, Tom gets with my office, and we try to work through it and come up with a vested rights determination. And of course, it's a mixed question of fact and law. One way to say it, there's no other way to say it. It's complicated. And we do the best that we can. We will typically get with the developer and look at the facts as they present them, and then we'll go back to the file, look at the facts as they're in the file, and then we'll get together and we'll talk about it. And I'll typically come up with a draft letter. And when I feel like I'm comfortable with the legal analysis, I'll run it by Mr. Brown. Mr. Brown will look at it, make sure he's comfortable with it, and we'll both sign it, kick it out. It's challenging, and it does present some issues. I think I brought one to you, one to this board one time, and said that, "Look, I've got a vested rights issue. We're making the call on it. I think it's a close question. I'd like there to be a public hearing on it." And the board wasn't inclined to do that. That's your right. That's fine. I was, at the time, I was concerned that it was a close enough call where, to the extent that the Zoning Procedures Act needed to be triggered, a public hearing would have sort of vindicated that concern, but that's okay. And these are decisions we're happy to make them, but I want to make them with you understanding that we're making them. I've got one now involving Jim King. He has come to us. You're going to not understand what the fact pattern is. It's real simple. We got a zoning before under Res 3 when the square footage allowance was 9,000 square foot lots. And there's now been a change in the zoning code in November 2007, requiring 14,000 plus square foot lots. He wants to know whether he's vested to develop under the old Res 3. And of course, I've issued opinions on this before, and the typical thing that has made it very important, it's been very important to me, is this. Whether under the prior zoning there was a zoning concept or zoning site plan that you approved that shows a certain number of lots, that's number one. Whether you had a zoning condition that provided a number that squared with that zoning concept plan. In other words, let's say the zoning concept plan showed 100 lots. Well, there may be a condition that says this development now shall have no more than 100 lots. So I've got 100 lots in my zoning condition. I've got 100 lots on my zoning concept plan. Therefore, my position is it's linked. The Board of Commissioners, when they adopted that zoning, clearly had in mind that concept plan as evidenced by that zoning condition. They link up together. That wasn't enough either. What I also was looking for is some sort of a significant financial expenditure based upon those approvals. And a lot of times what I had found was some previous examples involving both Ryland and Lennar, I had seen a sewer purchase. They bought sewer from us for the very same number of lots that were in that zoning concept plan and they're in that zoning condition. So if you put all those three together, you have an approved zoning site plan, approved zoning condition, and a lot of times several hundred thousands, if not up to $500,000 of sewer acquisition, to me that was enough to give rise to a vested right for them to go ahead and build out pursuant to the old RES 3 performance standards. Particularly when we've held their money for years in our account, in many instances for 3 or 4 or 5 years.
No interest.
We've held their money.
Usually some of these guys typically will put a piece of land under contract with conditions, and then certainly once they get their zoning, it matches their business plan, then they purchase the land as well based on what we've approved.
That's right. Mm-hmm. But again, you know, I've got to be, the county's got to be consistent. And so with Mr. King, I found that he did not have a vested right. And the reason is that he did have a zoning condition that named those units and said up to a certain number of units, but I could never reconcile myself that there was a zoning concept plan that matched that number of units.
Did he buy a sewer?
He did.
He
bought $500,000 of sewer.
In fairness and in all respect, the conditions that you look for are ones that you have put together, not specified by law. There are some that you have created to comply with the law.
Well said.
Now, one question I get, we keep getting these things. Do we not need to adopt some type of vested rights for these lots? Go back and see how many we got left of these R3 subdivisions and put them to bed. Some kind of criteria. Put them, so don't have to come before us all the time. So if you met,
you laid it out.
Yeah, if you met this, purchased sewer, you did this, did that, then you are vested in this piece of property.
I wouldn't even want it. Yes and no. Yes, I think we need to come up with some criteria to save this office from spending as much on fees as they're paying me to keep coming up with the. I mean, these are labor. I spent, you know, 4 or 5 weeks on these, and not, you know, every moment of every day, but it's a lot of time, is my point. But I don't want to come up with a rule that says here's the criteria you're vested. You just come up with a rule. I mean, you are the public, you know, you're the holders. Yeah, that's why you get to set the rules. And if you decide, for instance, that if you received a RES 3 zoning prior to November of 2007 and you bought sewer in reliance upon that for a certain number of units, I don't think you need to say therefore you're vested, because the vesting
but
is
you allowed that number of units.
That's right. That's
yeah,
different.
I mean, that's what we need, because most of these things were zoned with a specified number of units on the site plan, or limited to a number of units when they had them zoned.
Are we changing the density on this one?
No, I have simply found they're not vested. That means
even though they bought sewer, because there's no site plan.
There's no site plan. I mean, the law
but
is very.
Have you read my letter?
I'm saying that facetiously. My letter walks through. The law on zoning is very fact specific, and there is a vein of vested analysis that deals with reliance upon approved concept or zoning plans, and so. But again, if the zoning plan is unclear as to the number of units, even if you take and spend a lot of money on that zoning plan, they don't link up. They don't link up to provide a clear base. I am very conservative in making these calls, because you've just got staff and the county attorney making these very important calls. And so I feel like I have to be ultra conservative.
But again, in fairness and in respect, that's not the law that you've created something that you feel comfortable with. It's not something we have to comply with.
Well, I agree wholly to the fact that you're saying, Ken, it's the law as articulated by Ken Girard. Yes, that is right. Is that the only way anybody can see it?
No, because
absolutely somebody can see it.
What is the criteria in the UDC for vested rights?
The UDC doesn't have a vested rights criteria.
State law.
There's four seminal cases coming out of WMM Properties There's building permits. That's the easy one, right? If someone has an active building permit, they get to build in reliance upon that permit till it does what? Till it expires. That means if we change the code while the permit is pending, doesn't apply to them. They get to try and build out pursuant, and of course you know that if you do any development at all. I have been relying upon the right to rely upon an approved development plan by the county. An approved development plan accompanied by a significant expenditure of resources. But it's got to be a development plan that, at least in my mind, articulates a specific expectation. If the number of units depicted on the development plan doesn't match those zoning conditions, I'm not able to clearly state that's what the board had in mind. If they link up,
How many sewer taps did he buy? How much of dollars?
He bought 101.
So he expectation of having 100 or 101 lots.
And when did he buy?
He bought them before we changed the code.
Yeah. But
he had a letter from the director that said he had vested rights.
So how much money did he put out? How much did he come out of pocket?
$518,000.
$5,000. So if we grant him this consideration, we're saying he could build 101 houses, right?
No more.
Up to
yes, but I'm not asking you to do that. I'm not asking you to take action to declare he's vested. Tom and I have already concluded he's not. My simple question was, is I'm not sure that this is where you want to be with these decisions being made this way, or whether you want to give some of these folks some finality and some certainty as to how they go forward.
But what if we disagree with you that he is vested?
I think he is vested. He spent almost $600,000.
Then you need to fire me.
Well, don't say that.
Do what?
Well, I'm just saying, that's my legal conclusion.
Okay.
You've retained me to make those conclusions.
Can I ask you something?
I was being a little bit facetious there. if y'all really want to. That's not an agenda item, so we really can't do that.
Yeah.
Let me just say that, he said $600,000. Based on the assumption that he was going to have 101 homes. So he relied on that 101 homes to spend money. That's why it's a state law.
I respectfully did not conclude that.
Can I ask? I'd like to ask.
Sir.
Out of the 50.6 acres, under Res 3,
yes, sir.
Give me the exact percentage of lots or homes you get per acre.
What's the density?
That's just two units per lot.
Right.
That's just
way under
the 2.5.
He's using their open space.
Density
and
chances are,
help me show
that's
what I mean.
He's got 2.5.
Chances
are,
yeah. I'm just trying to show. I think you personally, what you say laws, but I will bet if this man brought a contract up, you'll see where he, I will buy this contingent upon zoning. We gave it to him. He bought sewer taps based on it.
Yeah.
I'm fine with this. I mean, a person does a business plan and takes all these precautions. We approve it. We let him go. The economy falls, so be it. He has to make a new business plan not to start right away. But he's already been approved. I don't know. I'm fine with it personally.
He's not adding to the density.
No.
Not adding any more houses.
Correct.
So if he makes the lot smaller from an environmental standpoint, that could be a good thing because you have more open space. That's just the good side of the small lots.
He wouldn't be asking for determination that he was vested to build the smaller lots if he didn't think that he needed it.
Yeah, and he may need it because of the topo or something like that, where he wants to, just leave part of the development alone.
Because if we don't give this to them,
concentrate the development in another part of the
development. But y'all are rolling out very practical, pragmatic reasons for why you want to give him the relief he's seeking. I'm telling you, under the law, as I see it, I don't think he would win on a I am vested to ignore your UDC.
Why does the government have to battle everybody all the time? Why do we have to shut down business?
That's why I'm here.
We're here to stop him, and I'm not saying we're trying to shut down business,
but
no.
When he wrote his check, he wrote a check thinking he was going to get 101 lots? How would he know that the, you know, that the economy, how would anybody know?
You don't want a rule of law in Forsyth County that if someone buys sewer, they forever have a right to build out a subdivision at a certain density. We have a sewer refund policy specifically to allow.
But you also approved the rest.
Then he spent other money as well.
I'm not saying it's a right, but I'm saying it should be something that we could consider on a case-by-case basis.
I agree with you, and that's what I'm doing. We have considered, I mean, if you look through here, it's a packet full of case-by-case basis is where we.
How many of these do you think we have?
We get two or three a month.
Can I propose something, and maybe y'all shoot me down, I'm okay with it?
Get rid of the
District Commissioner
board and let them
handle this.
Why don't we let the District Commissioner approve this? Well, the Director of Planning has the authority to make the determination, does he not?
The Director of Planning Development has the right to make interpretations of the code when, yes.
So couldn't a District Commissioner be given that same authority to let him review it and make that decision?
Let me offer this up. It's a good question. Let me offer this respectful response to you. One of the things you've got to have is you've got to have consistency in how our code is applied, and it's got to comply with the law. And the only person right now that's making those calls is me, and I hope you're comfortable with me making them as best I can. I'm bringing this to you because I see this as a problem in need of a solution.
You know what this reminds me of is these developments that have fines pending, and you know they're foreclosed on, and they get to be a new owner, and then we have to address how much of the old fines the new owner has to take or is responsible for. And we do hear that on a case-by-case basis, I think.
Well, except that finally what you all did a few months ago was you basically, in lieu of hearing those on a case-by-case basis, you adopted in total a fine reduction across the board so they can be handled administratively with ratification on your consent agenda. It's the same problem, just from a different perspective. This one manifests itself in planning, that was in engineering, but it's a byproduct of the housing burst.
That's what I'm saying. Can we adopt some resolution to justify? But I mean, we're sitting here sounding like we got four commissioners that disagree your legal opinion. I'm not a lawyer, but I'm a junior lawyer, like you.
Junior associate.
Can you name three criteria? And if they out of five possible criteria, can name if they meet three criteria? Y'all hear that? Let's say it's possible five criteria they can meet. If they meet at least three of the criteria, it's an automatic Tom Brown has the right
off
to
roll with it.
Yeah.
Have we denied one yet because they bought sewer? Have we denied?
This is the first one I can make up.
When they bought sewer, this is the first one.
This first one.
When they bought sewer, that's a major criteria. Yeah.
Have they asked
the game zone is another
one? No.
Are they in big creek?
They have?
No.
Okay. I don't think they have. Are we hearing, and this is for Mr., are we hearing about any other of these sorts of ones that don't involve Rest 3? Because, you know, that's the one we changed.
Right. That's the one we changed, 14.5.
The big one.
Might have one or two on older stream buffers. We also expanded our stream buffers in the last decade, but the majority of it
but
is
I
all
would
on
bet
Rest 3.
He's not wanting to build on lots 9,500 square feet throughout the whole subdivision, because the market is the market, and you know if the market's wanting 12,000,
I can tell you that
14,000 square feet. And then
if you take the density and multiply it by the lots, and he's only got 101 sewer taps, you're exactly right. He's not going to. He can't.
Yeah, but I bet there's a few in there that probably saves some money on rating or something.
The topo dictates a lot of these lots.
As long as they're not changing the density,
I'm fine with it.
Then if the market is for smaller lots, then that just means more concentrated green space in the development.
Which is around the outside, which is fine.
That's why we had the 9,000 square foot lots at one time.
That's right.
Have green space around it.
But that's an argument to change your UDC.
Yeah.
See, I can't change your UDC. You adopted the UDC in November 2007 to do something different than what you're advocating now. I've got to live with a UDC and figure out how I justify giving someone an exemption from it.
Now, are you saying we should
first anyway?
Are you saying we should deny this vested right in Jim King's case?
Tom and I've already done that. We're not coming to you asking you to do anything like that.
Why is it on the agenda?
Because I'm coming to you for the very thing you're grappling with, which is, I get it that you're concerned about
this,
it.
This agenda item tells me that it's the consideration of the vesting decision.
Yeah. That's what it says. But are you looking to overturn your decision with this? I mean, are we
I think not? I think that's what the agenda item is, quite frankly.
I mean, he says it's not. We think it is.
It says board consideration of administrative vesting decision.
You're considering it.
Yeah, but we're considering overturning your decision.
That's not what I'm asking you to do.
But we are.
Well, then change your decision.
I'm not going to change my decision. But if you want to authorize the planning director and me to come back with a solution that will take some criteria, including Mr. King, he would fit within this criteria as well, to basically stop the tap from us having to deal with three or four of these a month, particularly on these res three.
Why don't you make us a list of all the criteria you can come up that makes sense? And certainly one of them, I think, is the actual contract that they bought this land only based on the zoning that we were going to approve. Right. Once we approved it, that should be one. I think sewer should be another. I think the fact that we zoned it should be another. The fact that you want to do a count between site plan specific with the sewer taps could be another. And maybe there's another one in there somewhere you need to think of. And if they meet, and you have total five, and if they meet three of the five, I think we're there.
Now, we asked Tom this one time when we started with this fine reduction. Can we have,
It's a piece of this big
one. West Coast is on Ryan Duncan's side of it.
Yeah, that's true.
Aaron says
it's absolute.
Can we call it a shared deal again?
Yeah,
we call it shared.
That's right.
Is it north?
If it's west,
I don't think it's north.
And we took it.
And we kept it.
Yeah.
And we probably spent it.
That's all I need.
That's
yeah.
Well, Councilor, again, with due respect, the agenda item is a consideration of the vested, the vesting decision. So I think that it's. The board feels that was the discussion, and that's what we have been discussing.
If you choose to overrule it, that is certainly within your purview. I don't recommend
that's
it.
That's what I wanted to know. Thank you.
And then, secondarily, if we want to have Tom put together with input from the commissioners to Tom on some ideas on how to pull up with a checklist, if you will, that would best people and make a little cleaner up people.
It does. One of the best things, I don't think you have an option, has to be
a sewer. That's the decision I'm making. So does anybody want to make a motion?
Oh, I thought you were trying to make a motion.
No, I'm just saying that that's what we discussed. That's what the agenda item is. No, I'm saying, does somebody want to make a motion to that effect?
To rescind the administrative year?
Yeah, rescind and overturn the administrative decision.
And just grant them the vesting. Yeah. From this, is that correct? We're just granting them?
That's what you're doing.
Yeah.
On a case-by-case basis right now.
Right, until we come up with the criteria.
Do you feel comfortable this time?
Doesn't matter to you one way or the other on this one.
He doesn't care.
All this red tape is just kind of
dull. I would. We're talking in particular the second item of developing some kind of checklist, some kind of standard.
Sure.
I think it's very important.
Yeah, we need to.
But I think it's we failed somebody $600,000 for 5 years.
Took it.
You know, and it was 101 lots, and now all he wants to do is continue to build 101 units. He's not coming in saying, you know, I want to go back and now I want, where I had it was 101, now I want to take it to 150.
Yeah, he's not trying to change it. He's trying to continue, and it's still low density. I would not want to be, I guess I'm a proponent of allowing people to try to continue on. It's not that.
Well, we did zone it that way. We changed the zoning conditions.
Right. Well, he also had a letter from the previous planning director that said he was interested.
Oh, you did have a letter.
So what's the proper way to do this, counsel?
Tell me if I make a motion, if I'm correct.
Let's ask him first.
I mean, if you want to make a motion I guess just overturn the September 14th administrative determination to Jim King, that would be the way you make the motion.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second to the mayor. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. There is none. That passes 4-0.
Okay,
was that time sensitive, by the way? Did you
want to
make it time?
No, look, they've been 5 years.
Can we drink? I asked Mr. Brown to look at it.
Please. Without exception.
We need a motion on that.
Okay, item number 25.
Do you need a motion on that, Mr. King? Is he okay? Is he got a motion?
Without exception.
The direction to modify the UDC?
Yes.
No, not the direction to modify the UDC. Direction to come up with a checklist of items that could be used to signify.
Yeah, but you have to change the UDC.
We'll
bring it back.
We'll bring it back.
That's correct.
Consideration.
My question was, do you need a motion or is it just without exception?
Without exception, it's fine.
Somebody got talking over.
Without exception.
The chairman is.
Because we're bringing it back to the work session.
25. We had it. Number 25. I make a motion we postpone this. When does a work session have to mediation?
18th. Regular meeting on the 18th. That's a regular meeting. That's a regular meeting. 23rd. Well, that's not. Why don't we just go ahead and postpone until the 9th and then postpone it again, just in case.
That motion is postponed.
Counselor, shall we accuse myself on this vote?
I'm sorry, what is the motion?
Are you going to pay 25?
25 is water.
Number 25 is county water.
I would go ahead and accuse
myself
on this vote. The record reflect the Commissioner Amos has recused himself. Motion is to postpone this until October 9th. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. It's 3-0 with Commissioner Amos being accused and Commissioner Roth being MIA.
MIA?
MIA.
Missing action.
AWOL. Item number 26, Post Road Library Power. Is that right?
Yes, it is.
Yes, sir. Hold on, forgive me. I need to collect my.
Chris, did you bring yours by the way? Chris is supposed to bring yours.
No, sir, I'm loyal.
I can say that. You gotta
say yours.
Union says I can smart off. Those are my vested rights. How about that?
Don't be a trouble.
Mr. Vice Chairman, member of the board, this is.
States his worst moment of play. We don't remember.
You got
said it.
You got Brian to talk about that one time.
Oh, I'm thinking it all the time.
With all due respect.
all due respect.
Respectfully.
This is simply a electricity power easement between Forsyth County and the Sawney Electric Membership Corporation in order to run power to the Post Road Library facility. This is a form that we had prepared and gone over with Sawney over and over again in previous situations, exactly the same as this, and they have adopted our form. So I'm very comfortable with this for y'all to approve it.
In that case, I make a motion that we accept the right-of-way easement between Forsyth County and Sawney EMC for the right-of-way easement for power for the Post Road Library.
Time sensitive. Second, time sensitive.
Motion is second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
All
those opposed, like sign. This is 4-0 with Commissioner Roth being absent.
We have the next item, Vice Chairman.
Yes, we are. Thank you. Counselor, and I am number 27. Okay.
Members of the board, this next item is an agreement to proceed at risk. Yesterday, myself, Mr. Lucas, Mr. Barrett had a meeting pursuant to the tri-party agreement with representatives of Setting Down Utility and Waterscape Utility related to the Hampton Wastewater Reclamation Facility near the Hampton subdivision. The purpose was to try and iron out some of the disputes that particularly Setting Down and Waterscape are having. Those disputes, of course, have led to litigation. They want the county to be involved in litigation. We have, in fact, tried to interplead some money in that litigation that we owe one of those two parties related to our monthly sewer treatment fees. But nonetheless, there is an innocent bystander, if you will, that has not now gotten caught up in this litigation, and that is the Oaks Senior Living LLC. They are trying to build an 80-some-odd assisted living facility and connect to the Hampton sewer plant. They have spent over $167,000 with Waterscape buying sewer, and now Setting Down has come in and said, we don't recognize the legitimacy of that purchase, and therefore, county, you should not recognize the legitimacy of that purchase, and therefore, you should put a stop work on them. We then did put a stop work on them while we had the meeting yesterday in hopes that we would work out a compromise or a consensus. We couldn't. So what we're prepared to do, and I've talked with the representatives of Oaks, is that we're prepared to allow the Oaks to proceed at risk, understanding that until there's a resolution of who was the appropriate party entitled to their money, they may not have sewer, but we're not going to hold them up on the permitting stage and harm them just because Setting Down and Waterscape can't seem to see eye to eye. So they've already looked at this, they're comfortable with it, and I would ask that you all approve it on a time-sensitive basis. There's no place for us to sign, but I would ask that you ratify it, and then I'll let them sign it, and then we'll issue their permits. They've got trucks on the ground that need to go forward more. Yes, sir.
Your date on here is 25th of October. Should that be September?
Should be September. It should be September, actually. Okay. Thank you.
I make a motion that we approve the agreement to proceed to risk as described by the county attorney.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. Passes 4-0 with Commissioner Bob being gone. Yes, sir?
Can I address y'all just for a second?
On what item?
Oh, just on what y'all just passed. I just had a concern about it, trying to help you.
Are you going back to item?
I'm trying to help you. Okay. Y'all already voted on it. I'm concerned that you set the precedent to help one guy that you maybe give yourself. I mean, I'm just in here thinking and trying to help you out here. That you may be helping this one guy, and it may be mushrooming where y'all end up with a whole bunch of other problems. And I think, I'm not sure if that's what Ken was talking about at all. But I think you have another option, which would be maybe to postpone making a decision and learn more about it from Ken. I'm not criticizing you about it, I'm just saying, it could stand a little more looking into it.
Not as far as I know.
Any other residents
buried on the ground,
for example, that they did.
the old zoning. I mean, how can they turn anybody else down now? They can't. They can't. We get the public study, so we can prepare for executive session.